Can roll, everyone. Okay. Good morning and welcome to the 25th meeting in 2024 of the Finance and Public Administration Committee. I'd first like to congratulate committee members Liz Smith, Michelle Thompson and Mike O'Mara for winning the Political Hero, Backbencher of the Year and jointly the Business of Political Award at last week's Holyrood Political Awards 2024. But I am, of course, disappointed that colleagues did not refuse these awards in solidarity with the convener, who, through some oversight, was not nominated. We have one public item on the agenda today, which is to take evidence on managing Scotland's public finances, a strategic approach, from two panels of witnesses as part of our pre-budget scrutiny this year. For the first panel, I'd like to welcome to the meeting Richard Robinson, Senior Manager, Performance Audit and Best Value at Audit Scotland, Professor David Bell, Fellow Royal Society of Edinburgh, and Professor David Heald, Emeritus Professor and Honorary Senior Research Fellow, Adam Smith Business School at the University of Glasgow. And as we have your submissions, we will move straight to questions. I'm going to allow around 90 minutes for this session. If witnesses wish to be brought in at any time, please indicate to clerks. I can then call you. So without further ado, I think we'll start at the very beginning, as Julie Andrews once sang. Mr. Robinson, in terms of the Scottish Government priorities, we've obviously set out some 11 questions, which we get very detailed answers from, excellent answers, and I want to thank you all for your submissions. And in the second paragraph of the first question, your response was, and I quote, you said, "Activities to eradicate child poverty rely upon social security payments, education spending, well-paid work in a flourishing economy and many other factors. For the priorities to be meaningfully felt and understood in the annual budget, a clear articulation of how services and spending will work together will be required." Is this happening?
In some positive developments last year during the emergency budget review, we refer in our submission to the mandate letters that sets that out. So I think what we're saying in our submission is that it would be useful to see that type of thing replicated for budgets. So as we know, spending will take place within different departments of Scottish Government, whether that's health or the economy or educational skills.
Sorry, just to interrupt you just for a second. I think for the record, would you like to explain what a mandate letter is?
So a mandate letter was set out during the emergency budget statement last year, and it allowed a statement for each of the spending areas of the Scottish Government to say how their spending was going to match against the priorities of government. That's important because it allows an understanding across government of how different things are working together. And what's clear with the recommendations that are set out, whether that's child poverty, whether that's growing the economy, climate emergency, those same principles are going to apply in terms of the cross-government nature of them and understanding how the different changes in spending across different portfolios is going to be quite important. The second thing we raise is these priorities obviously won't be achieved overnight. They'll require on a shared endeavour over a number of years. So as well as highlighting the importance of clarity around which are the areas of spending that are going to work together to deliver these priorities, it's also important to be clear over those medium-term plans how that sustained effort is going to develop. The final point we raise on this is really about the opportunities with the National Performance Framework, which we know is undergoing a refresh. So there's opportunities there, again, over that medium-term to say, well, how are those shared endeavours that are set out in the medium-term plans or multi-year spending, if that term starts next year, matching across to the improvement in outcomes, as we can see in the National Performance Framework.
Okay, and Professor Bell, do you feel that the pace of progress is adequate given the situation that we're in at the moment, or do you feel the government could do more to accelerate work in delivering its priorities?
So, I don't think the generality of these priorities is anything particularly new, and progress thus far hasn't been all that quick. And in a way, it perhaps speaks to what Richard has said around the focusing on the delivery of these outcomes, some of which are pretty difficult. The child poverty one is probably a long-term issue that cannot be easily addressed overnight. But without a multi-year focus on the delivery and a clear way of measuring and making sure that there is delivery, it seems to me that progress could be somewhat quicker than it's been.
Okay, and one of the interesting things that you've said actually in your own submission, Professor Bell, is that you said that one high-level observation we'd make on this consultation exercise is that in many cases it asks the wrong questions. I'm just wondering, you want to talk about that in some detail, but I'm just wondering if you could explain to us why you believe it's the wrong question being asked and what questions should really be asked.
Well, so the fundamental issues around achieving the goals that we're trying to, as far as Scotland is concerned, as far as the Scottish Government has set out, seem to me to involve thinking about the kind of behaviours, the kind of innovation in detail that are required to deliver on these promises, and the path down which we need to travel isn't perhaps clear to all the potential actors who have stakes in delivery of these objectives. So it seems to me a more clear focus on the overall objectives is at least one way of thinking more clearly about where it is we currently are and where we're trying to get to.
Okay, thank you. And Professor Heald, one of the areas that you great expertise and indeed that you've spent a lot of time on in terms of the submission is, of course, taxation. And I think when I read your submission, there seems a great feeling of frustration, correct me if I'm wrong, coming through this in terms of what you've basically said is that the UK tax system is a complete mess and the Scottish Government hasn't really done anything to kind of ameliorate that. So I'm just wondering again, for the record, how you feel the Scottish Government should make progress in addressing that particular issue.
I'll start by saying that for about 50 years, I've been a strong advocate of devolved taxes. I do not think that this Parliament has actually done at all well with the exercise of devolved taxes. The difficulty, basically three taxes that really matter in terms of money. That's Scottish income tax, council tax, and business rates. I know very little about business rates, but I know a lot about council tax and about Scottish income tax. On council tax, it's ludicrous that one's still using 1991 values. Everybody knows that, but no political party dare move. And that comes to one of the points that I would like to make very strongly. Unless the Parliament can find some way of building cross-party consent on reforming council tax, what will happen? The system will get more and more irrational, more and more inequitable, more and more inefficient. It's incredibly difficult politically. I fully understand that. But it reflects very badly on the Parliament that doesn't happen. In terms of income tax, Scottish income tax, we have these ludicrous marginal rates connected with the different higher rate thresholds and also with the withdrawal of personal allowance on income between 100,000 and roughly 125,000. So you end up with marginal rates of 50% on middle earners, almost 70% on high earners. It's even more complicated if you're bringing things like student loans, repayment of student loans, and about withdrawal of child benefit for higher earners. The Parliament hasn't thought about how we live with a UK tax system, try to persuade the UK governments to actually improve the UK tax system, but not to make things worse. So I think the crucial points are revaluation for council tax, because essentially the wrong people are paying council tax now. And I think that a very important issue the Parliament will have to think about is whether revaluation is intended to generate more income or actually make a more equitable and efficient system. Because I think it would be very... Politically, I think it would be more difficult to get a revaluation if the story gets round that there's just going to be very big tax increases for everybody. I think there has to be a clear lead from the Parliament and government about what the context of a revaluation will be. And I think that the other point about Scottish income tax is the Parliament's in a very weak position relative to the UK government, because the UK government can change anything at any time. The Parliament can only set Scottish income tax before the beginning of the tax year. So it's really very important that Parliament thinks very clearly about what it wants the Scottish tax system to look in 10 years' time. It will take quite a long time to improve the system. And obviously quite a lot depends on what the UK government does in the meantime.
I think the issue you've touched on, obviously, is politics. I mean, you know, the Scottish government is in a minority situation, you know, 18 months before an election. The opposition parties are very unlikely to get on board with whatever the Scottish government says, one would think. Would it not be, do you think, in terms of council tax, maybe with the UK, with a huge majority, could perhaps take the lead on such an issue as council tax reform?
I would hope the UK will do something. I mean, English local government is in total chaos at the minute. Many councils can't even actually do their accounts on anything remotely on time. One would hope for a lead, but one of the things that the new government did was tie its hands with relation to national insurance, with relation to VAT, and relation to income tax. One of the things that worries me about that context is the UK government may well use highly inefficient taxes as a way of plugging budget gaps rather than use the broad-based taxes. My own view is that it's the broad-based taxes which are fairer and cause less inefficiency to the functioning of the market economy.
And we're going to see a lot more fiscal drag.
I mean, fiscal drag is the main policy which the previous UK government established and actually is now looks as it may well be continued by the new government.
Okay, yeah. David, you want to come in? I mean, you've said, for example, that you would like to look at, the RAC would like to look at, and I quote, all tax options.
Sure. There have been a variety of reviews of UK tax system. The one most notable one being that by the Institute for Fiscal Studies, the Merrill-Lease Review, and it echoes what David has just said, particularly in relation to taxes like council tax, and I completely agree with David's sentiments around its current nature, its current inefficiency and its current inequity. In terms of in terms of taxes overall, our tax burden is at an extremely high level historically, but strangely, in terms of direct taxes, average earners have had the tax rates are historically low. It's on these other taxes that money is being generated for the UK system, and also from an extremely greater contribution from the very high earners. The top 1% of earners contribute 30% of income tax revenues. Other European countries, which have much higher rates of taxation, basically do it by taxing middle-income earners more highly than we currently do. And of course, in a sense, the fiscal drag, which you just mentioned, is actually taking us back to a situation a few years ago when, before personal allowances were raised by the Conservative government quite rapidly, and now we're kind of by stealth reverting to that position. Obviously, it does drag people into higher tax bands with some stealth, but also this situation in regards to marginal rates of particularly those earning between 100,000 and 120,000, it seems to me there is a very clear case for going to the UK government and saying, how can we fix this? Because it may cause key people to be less willing to supply their labour.
Okay, and if they are not of a mind to do that, and I don't see any evidence that they are at this point, what can the Scottish Government do in terms of its own budget to try and make things more rational, shall we say?
I mean, there is always an answer in that you can put in an offsetting set of tax adjustments at the different bands to offset the jumps that are suddenly occurring. But it seems difficult for me to that the Scottish Government could do this sort of unilaterally. I guess could, but the way ahead, it seems to me, is to think about the whole system, and really the UK government probably should lead that. The one tax we haven't mentioned is stamp duty, which is a crazy tax, and the UK government could take the lead in seeking ways to find an alternative revenue generating system that obviated the need to have this tax.
Okay. Mr. Robinson, you've said in your submission that any tax strategy to consider the overall costs and benefits should be clear about how these align with its tax framework. So should the Scottish Government publish behavioural impacts anticipated from its decisions?
Yes, I'd probably take a step back and say, I think, as we say earlier in the submission, the balance or the path to a sustainable budget will rely upon a mixture of spending, growth in the economy and tax policy together. So part of it is being clear to what degree the Scottish Government expects over the short and medium term tax to play that role in bridging what we know is a fiscal gap in the finances. So, as has already been said, fiscal drag has played a big part in that with the additional banding in Scotland. One of the things that's currently under consideration at the Scottish Government, and some work has been done by HMRC on this, is the effect at which the divergence in Scotland is leading to behavioural change. And that's slightly different, I think, from points around equity and fairness and those types of things. It's to what extent are people going to change their tax behaviour, leave Scotland, not come to Scotland, and choose to pay themselves in dividends as a result of that. So the more information on that, the better. And the reason for that is it would help the Scottish Government to understand the extent to which tax policy can be used as a lever. So as we've seen from last year's SFC analysis produced with the budget, there was behavioural change in there in terms of the effect that the tax policy was going to have, with the majority of the medium-term picture being raised through the fiscal drag. So understanding the extent to which tax or tax divergence and further change away from the UK position can lead to additional sums for the Scottish budget is quite important, because the rest is going to have to be managed through growth in the economy or understanding and prioritising spending. So I think it's that clarity around the role that each of the three levers are going to play over time, which is going to be quite important.
Okay, thank you for that. Now, one of the issues that you mentioned, or you talk about in some detail in terms of the question we asked about capital expenditure, was about transparency. So you've said that the Scottish Government should understand what effect its prioritisation of its capital projects will have on achieving its ambitions of growing the economy, improving public service and tackling climate change. But you also add that the Scottish Government should be transparent about how these decisions and how and why they've been made and the impact it will have on public services.
That's right, and colleagues of mine did a report on infrastructure investment last year or earlier this year. We understand that there's developments in terms of the prioritisation of the IOP, which we would encourage. I think this is just a case of understanding the reality of the capital budget. So the Scottish Government has already said that it cannot afford to proceed with all of the things that it would like to in terms of capital. And that means the prioritisation of what it can spend is going to be incredibly important. So I suppose going back a little bit to the first question that was asked, which was about the priorities and the clarity of how different elements of spending are working towards those. So we would expect to see that kind of clarity, whether that's against the priorities set out in this paper or otherwise, to say these are the areas that we've prioritised because we expect these to make the biggest difference towards tackling child poverty, delivering excellent services, climate change and so on.
And do you have concerns that the capital pipeline programme, which we were supposed to receive early this year, has been repeatedly delayed and won't now appear until after the budget?
I think many of these questions are really on the theme of what is enabling. So we're auditors, so we're interested in supporting scrutiny. So what are the things that would best allow parliamentarians to scrutinise the budget? So that will include capital information. It will also include information about the medium-term financial strategy, medium-term financial picture, and as well as the tax strategy that's expected alongside the budget. So I think it's the extent to which parliamentarians, when scrutinising budget, can see how those prioritisations have been achieved and what those difference that they're going to make over the medium term.
And Professor Bell, you've said that carefully planned public sector investments will be crucial to help to achieve the increase in productivity growth that is critical for the future of our economy and the public finances. And of course, there's great concern about productivity at the moment. So what kind of areas do you believe that capital should be invested in order to boost that productivity at this time?
So the UK public sector... the UK does not have a great record on public sector capital spend. It has an even worse record on private sector capital spend. So where public sector investment can catalyse the private sector to invest more seems to me to be an important area to be thinking about. Seems to me that given the overall priorities, that might, Scottish Government priorities, that might include work around housing. It would include measures that might help the renewable sector. These kinds of areas that clearly align with the Scottish Government's overall priorities, where public sector spending can help, given that it is a relatively small proportion of total investment potentially, but where the public sector can leverage in more private sector investment, surely that would be one way of thinking about the best way to use our public sector investment.
And Professor Heald, you've obviously expressed great concern about the issue of productivity as well. Where do you feel that the Scottish Government should take forward its capital expenditure, given the fact that you've been very critical of the reduction of capital expenditure in recent years as allocated by the UK Government?
I'm not in a position to know a great deal about the position about capital spending across the sectors, which the Scottish Government's responsible for. The point I would make is that the standard reflex of the UK Government, which knocks onto the Scottish Government, is to cut capital when fiscal times get hard. Alistair Darling, who, in my view, was an excellent Chancellor of the Exchequer, reacted to the global financial crisis by cutting capital. Since then, the UK performance on public sector capital has been very, very poor. Low in terms of totals, but also poor in terms of execution as well. So there's a double problem. It's not just how much you spend, it's how effectively whether things are brought in to time and to time and to budget. So I think that it's not crucially, it's a question about the quantity and quality of public sector capital spending, and also the degradation of public sector facility assets. It's not just the question of new facilities. You only have to go around Scotland and England as well to see the fact that the physical state of the infrastructure is deteriorating. So it's a maintenance problem. If you don't look after your assets, they will actually deteriorate faster than they would if you looked after them well. So there's a double issue. It's a question, very clearly, when governments come under pressure, the temptation is just to basically protect existing services and existing jobs and to cut back on capital. And given the starting position in terms of degradations of the capital stock and the lack of recent investment, it's really very important that we don't go through the same cycle again.
Okay, thank you. Professor Bell?
Just one small point, that just in addition to what David has said, there has been quite a lot of discussion recently about why it costs so much more to put public infrastructure in place in the UK compared with other parts of Europe, where you know, protections of labour are much more extensive, perhaps, than they are here. But that seems to me to be an issue that is really worthy of some serious research.
Yeah, I remember visiting the Faroe Islands and being astonished at the low cost of actually building tunnels that were 10, 20 kilometres long. And at one time we were talking about building a tunnel under the Forth, around the Forth Bridge, and it was costed at some ridiculous figure of about $2 billion. And yet, years later, the Faroe Islands can build huge infrastructure projects for a fraction of that price. So that's a very important point. Just one final question from myself before I open up to colleagues, and that's about the issue of the climate emergency, which is also one of the government's four priorities. Earlier this year, myself and other colleagues attended a presentation by the Scottish Fiscal Commission looking at this, and they costed to 2045, obviously, this is not an exact science, but they said it was going to cost both the public and private sectors a combined £185 billion in Scotland, much of which would have to be paid by the public sector, either devolved or UK, but also a lot from the private sector. Now, per capita, that's a lot of money, about £35,000 each. And they broke it down by sectors, and whether it be public and private, which areas would have to pay. So do you feel one thing they emphasised was the fact that the longer we delay taking action on this, the more expensive it's going to be to ultimately to mitigate it. Do you feel that in terms of its budget, the Scottish Government should do more to focus on this particular issue and make it clear in portfolios how they're actually doing that? And Professor Bell, you're looking skyward, so I'm going to ask you first.
I guess, you know, the issue of moving quickly makes some sense, but you don't want to move wrongly. If where there are significant requirements for change, and what we've done so far is to make big changes successfully in terms of electricity generation, but then there are other sectors that are more tricky. It seems to me, to agriculture possibly being one example, to make changes to help the move towards net zero. It seems to me that one has to be very careful there, not to take the wrong path, and also to take the actors to have some kind of consensus around the way forward, and an understanding that the extent to which change will be in the general public interest, and that is not an easy task. It takes considerable organisational and managerial effort for that to happen. So, my view at the moment is certainly let's get there, but don't do so by taking a number of wrong turnings, and do so in a way which takes the relevant actors along with you.
So what would a wrong turn be, for example?
Well, schemes that are not fully thought through. You know, the EV revolution has kind of stalled slightly because people are not sure whether they're going to be able to recharge their vehicles.
Get from A to B.
Yeah. You've got range anxiety, that sort of thing. Now, I'm fairly confident that the technology for that will come in the medium term, probably. But you don't want to lose public confidence by going off in the wrong direction. There's a great danger with so doing.
If I could just come in at that point.
Of course, yeah.
One of the important things when Gordon Brown set up the spending review system in 1998 was the idea of having multi-year planning of public spending. Preferably, multi-year spending for the whole of the UK Parliament, for the whole of the Scottish Parliament. Since the global financial crisis, spending reviews have come along rather erratically for very short periods. You cannot plan capital expenditure on a year-to-year basis. Capital has got to be planned for a substantial period ahead, both in terms of planning the public resources and also making sure that the private sector has got the capacity to bid for the contracts and execute the contracts. So it's crucially important, not just that we protect capital spend, but that we actually plan capital spend on a reasonably long-term period. And one of the reasons why we have overspends on capital projects is that you get a splurge of investment. The private sector construction industry builds itself up to do that, then the supply of funds stop, the capacity is eroded, and then at some point you have a crisis and actually start again. So it's really quite important that both at the UK level and at the Scottish level, one goes back to multi-year planning. It's very interesting. One of the standard responses you get from the people who respond to your consultations are to ask for multi-year funding. But of course, the problem is the Scottish Government can't really give multi-year funding guarantees to local government or the third sector if it hasn't got a reasonable degree of certainty about what's coming from the UK Government.
Yes, well, we hope that'll change in the not too distant future. Richard?
I was just going to add to that. So one of the points that we raise is about what is the Scottish Government's contribution to something that's wider than the Scottish Government. So EV is a good example of that, I think, insofar as it's going to be private investment in addition to UK Government investment in addition to Scottish Government investment, which is going to see that progress or stability that's required in order to make that change. So for the Scottish Government to be clear in its budget about what contribution or how best it can maximise the impact of its financial contribution to that will be very important to it. And that may change over time, but I think that role of cooperation and how that works with the private sector, the UK Government, is going to be quite important. And I think there's another wider point, which probably comes back to the point around almost like the tendency to protect resource over capital, is that, as it set out, as the SFC set out with the climate and that kind of financial impact over the long term, it said the same about health, didn't it? The huge impact that changes in health and ageing population will have, which then puts the impetus then on, well, what are the preventative measures now, the stitch in time saves nine, that are going to be required through the budget and through the medium term to help mitigate that. It can be difficult, I think, with longer term spending measures or preventative measures to get the bandwidth in the budget, because while some of them might see immediate benefits, others you can't necessarily quantify the difference that it's, or the return that it's going to have in the short term, which is why we think it's particularly important for strategies within the Scottish Government that support the budget to be clear about those areas where they're expecting a longer-term return, whether that's climate, whether that's healthcare, to be clearly set out and the spending that's related to that to be monitored closely.
David?
Well, just to add to that, I mean, we've talked about preventative spend probably before Christie, but certainly since Christie, and we haven't made, in my opinion, a huge amount of progress on that. I was on Health and Social Care Committee last week, and the argument was put by one of the witnesses there that there should be a separate preventative spend budget, which is ring-fenced for the kinds of purposes that Richard was describing. And I agree that it's much more difficult to monitor the effects of preventative spending because the positives come down the line quite a long way. And other things may have happened in between times. So trying to figure out what the real effect of the preventative spend has been is difficult. But that doesn't mean that you shouldn't try to do it.
I think in the 11 to 16 Parliament, there was a £500 million 3-year ring-fence budget. But the difficulty was, and John's asked questions about this many times, he's quite messianic about it, was trying to get organisations to disinvest in existing programmes. So even though you had that £500 million on top, people said, well, that's great, thanks very much. But there's still a real resistance to doing that. It's very difficult. I think one of the points Richard made is important about cooperation, because one of the things the SFC emphasised is that, for example, an issue like peatlands restoration, although most of the peatlands are in Scotland, the UK itself can't achieve its own climate targets without peatland restoration in Scotland, so therefore the cooperation is important. Okay, I'm going to open out the session to colleagues. The first to ask questions will be listed before by John.
Thank you. Could I just pursue some issues about tax, and thank you for your responses to date to the convener, because I think you've set out very clearly what some of the problems are, very forcibly, about some of the difficulties that both the UK tax system and the Scottish tax system has. Can I ask you, in terms of the available data that we have, how easy is it to work out, in terms of the revenue take, the efficiency of that revenue take, in terms of behavioural change? Are we able to interpret what the behavioural changes are with the current tax system that we have?
So that's a very difficult question.
I know, it's an important one.
It's very important. So there are various forms of that behavioural change might take. It might make people work less, might make them seek to avoid tax more, tax rules might encourage them to switch from income tax to capital gains. And then one that's focused on a lot is it may make people less willing to come to Scotland and some people more willing to leave Scotland. And there's another one which must worry economic development agencies, in that Scotland may acquire a negative reputation as far as it being a high tax area, where that could cause them problems. The way of actually trying to measure these behavioural effects is never going to be complete. What Richard mentioned earlier was around choosing a bunch of people, HMRC choosing a bunch of people south of the border, north of the border of roughly equivalent incomes, see how the Scots ones change their behaviour post the change in the marginal tax rates. And they have demonstrated an effect, but that's only one part of all of the effects, because of the effects on firms and the migration effects, which are extremely difficult. Other thing, going back to what I said earlier, a key issue is around high earners. And the response may not be linear in terms of how they react to higher marginal rates. It may, there may be a tipping point, and then large numbers of people move. I mean, I know of people that moved. It's not the case that no one has moved. So that requires a lot of work. Part of the difficulty, of course, is that the tax figures, the aggregates themselves, are become available so far in arrears after the end of the tax year, way after the end of the tax years, because people have time to submit self-employed people who are doing that kind of return. So there is still additional work to do on this, but I think that between the Fiscal Commission, the Fiscal Commission seems to have engaged very closely with this work, and I'm hoping that they will be coming up with some more detailed answers to your question in the not too distant future.
Yeah, I mean, I think part of this, we discussed this last week as well, that part of the issue in all of this question is about the economic inactivity and the reasons for that economic inactivity, some of which is obviously very justified post-COVID for health, mental health issues. But, you know, there is quite a large section of that inactivity of people who could be at work, but for one reason or another have chosen not to do that. And I think we've had various examples, Dundee being one, where, you know, they're quite keen to try to get these people back into the labour market for obvious reasons. And I just wonder if you feel that we are doing enough to try to promote the policies that will do that, and whether we have enough information to sort of back up what's working.
So that's probably not an issue to do with the marginal tax rates in Scotland, because a lot of the younger people who are now seemingly inactive wouldn't be up at the higher rates straight away when they entered the labour market. I've done some work with David Blanchflower recently on mental health, and mental health problems among younger people have increased very markedly post-pandemic, but also they were starting to be problematic before the pandemic. And the UK seems to be in a worse position than other advanced countries. Overall, in terms of the effect on growth in the economy, the effect on people's well-being, it seems to me this is a hugely important area. And I didn't have time to research it, but I did actually see a story in the Times this morning that that a large proportion of these people who are inactive are recent graduates.
Mm. And do we know, Professor Bell, as to why the UK's record on this is not as good as other countries? I mean, what's the evidence showing as the reason for that?
Well, I mean, some of it, I guess, is the institutional framework, which is there to try to help people to get into work. I do remember, this is going some time back, where youth employment was a problem in the UK, and I was working on comparisons with Germany. And I do recall one of our German colleagues arguing that in Germany, where the apprenticeship system is much better developed than is the case in the UK, it was seen as a sort of societal responsibility to help people through the transition from education and into work. We just don't have that culture. It's not something that can be quickly put in place, but if we start to realise that we need to do better, yeah, at least, that okay, that could make a difference.
Could I intervene and come back to your original question? What really matters for the budget is what the Scottish Fiscal Commission thinks, yeah, is going to be the behavioural effects. And in terms of the increase in the top rate, they think that 85% of the revenue disappears. And in the context of the advance rate, they think that 50% of the revenue disappears. Now, I think there'll be arguments for many years about whether those numbers are correct. But given the way that budget scoring works, the practical position for the Parliament and the government is that those are the numbers that count.
Yeah. Yeah, fair point. Just one final point, Professor Heald. You gave a very interesting analysis about the problems within tax structures earlier. To what extent do you feel that the UK, and indeed the Scottish Government, particularly the UK, is paying enough credence to the debates about global taxation, particularly when it comes to things like environmental policy and tax avoidance, all these things? Do we have to be more cognizant of what's happening in that area?
We now live in a world economy which is actually much more mobile. It's very mobile at a corporate level. The OECD has done a great deal of work on trying to rationalise corporate tax and try to get less avoidance of corporate tax. But it's incredibly difficult, and there seems to be a mixed record on how successful that has been. One of the things which I think the UK could do better would be to better resource HMRC in terms of its tax compliance. Okay. I mean, people talk glibly about the size of the tax gap, but the HMRC has taken very substantial staffing cuts over recent years. Mm. So I think that though governments quite like to say we're going to get X billion from less tax avoidance, without actually any substance behind that, it does seem to me that is somewhere, both for efficiency reasons and equity reasons. I think taxpayer perception of the tax system is really very, very important. If people believe there's lots of tax avoidance, that may well tempt them to go in for tax avoidance themselves, or possibly for evasion, but certainly any moral qualms about tax evasion will actually be reduced. So I think that having more emphasis, better resourcing for HMSE, but very clearly the behavioural effects, some of them are perfectly legitimate reactions of people. So the behavioural effects might be a mixture of illegality, but a lot of it will be actually people making different decisions. And in terms of high middle earners, the interaction of the tax system with child benefit withdrawal obviously creates incentives for part-time working. And part-time working is not... People moving to part-time working not through personal preference, but because of the incentives in the tax and benefit system, is actually not conducive to the economic growth, which is fundamental to achieving all the First Minister's four objectives.
Thank you.
Rachel, do you want to come in?
Yeah, just to, I think, strike a bit of a distinction maybe with compliance and then legal behavioural change, which I think is quite important here. So each year the NAO will produce a report on the assurances over Scottish income tax, and we produce a report alongside it for additional assurance in the Scottish context. Currently, as it stands, HMRC regard the compliance risk, so that's the risk that people just evade tax, they should pay tax and they don't, as being the same in Scotland as it is anywhere else in the UK. So in terms of the way that factors through the fiscal framework into the budget, it's kind of treated in the same way as anywhere else in the UK, just divided up as a proportion of the amount. So where that would cause a problem is if the divergence becomes so wide that the HMRC think there's a specific different risk to Scotland, that people are more likely to evade tax in Scotland than elsewhere in the UK. That's not currently the case. That could be the case in the future, depending on how it diverges. And that's slightly different from some of the behavioural elements, which are completely fine. It's just to do with how people choose to live their lives, how many hours they choose to work, how they choose to pay themselves in a legal way, or where they choose to live. So the issue there is how the Scottish Government, and this is where the data comes in, as you mentioned about the HMRC data, is that do the Scottish Government have the best information to determine what's going to happen if they make certain changes or make certain changes to the economy? So that, and with all of these things, it's relative impact. So As Professor Heald said, there's there's inactivity, and there's an inactivity issue all over the UK. Where it will make a difference to the Scottish Government will be if inactivity can improve better in Scotland than it does in the rest of the UK. So the issue for the Scottish Budget and the Scottish Government is what types of measures can it put in place in Scotland to help with inactivity or what have you, because then it will see the relative return of that through increased taxes.
Thank you. John, to be followed by Michael.
Thanks very much, Convener. I mean, the Convener touched on the kind of idea of longer-term planning, medium-term financial strategy, all that kind of thing going forward. But I was struck, Mr. Robinson, by a line in your submissions which says, more will be known following the UK budget expected on 30th October, at which point the Scottish Government must look to see how sustainable its current plans are. And that kind of says that we can't plan for the future, because even for the coming year, we're having to wait to the 30th of October to see what the scenario is. I mean, are we being unrealistic? Because this committee's been pushing for more long-term planning from the Scottish Government. Is that unrealistic?
So I'm not sure exactly where in the submission that is, but I think this
page
is
six. Answer to question six. Yes.
Six. Yeah. So. Some of this is, so as has been already brought up, some of this is about the largest player in the Scottish budget is still Barnett Consequentials. So what the UK government does in its budget obviously is going to have a large impact on what the Scottish government has in place. This goes into a little bit of the way that the fiscal framework operates, though. So in terms of, say, wage, as we know, wage increases have been a substantial pressure on the in-year budget, and part of the reasons for the changes in the budgets to allow some of those movements to come through. So if the UK government, and that's driven as well by the fact that the UK government have announced similar measures, as you know, in terms of pay deals, if the UK government decides to fund some or part of it or all of it through increased taxation or increased borrowing, then that will result in an increase to the Scottish budget through increased Barnett Consequentials, because it would just effectively there'd be more spending, more money available, and therefore the Scottish Government gets its change. If the changes are, well, each of the UK government departments is just going to have to manage these increased costs within its existing budgets, then that doesn't bring any additional money to the Scottish Government. So, apologies, I'm saying things that members are already aware of, but that's why it's going to make such a big difference, I think, because the extent to which the UK government budget is going to pay for it by one means or another will affect what is the budget within the gift of the Scottish Government to make its own decisions.
So, I mean, you're kind of underlining my point, I think, that, I mean, if the UK government for the next few years was to give a 5% pay increase to everybody, we would be under huge pressure to do the same. If they gave 2%, as had been thought. So it's just almost impossible for us to plan further ahead, isn't it?
So I suppose I'm probably going to go back to the Budget Process Review Group recommendations 2017, which is setting out a number of recommendations about what would help support a budget. And so some of those relate to multi-spending plans. And as has already been mentioned, where the UK government would have a more regular spending plan in place, that would make it easier for the Scottish government to plan itself over the medium term. That's slightly different to some of the recommendations about medium term strategies, which are more about assessing the scenarios and what the Scottish government would do. And the idea of that is to have more of a kind of a planned reaction, as opposed to a reaction based on what the UK government may do in any given year. So we've always been of the view in Audit Scotland that when things are uncertain, and that is going to be uncertainty at a UK government level, uncertainty, and, you know, we've been through COVID and cost of living and all the rest of it, the planning is more necessary, not less necessary. The scenarios may be wider. It may well be that you get more or less tax than you thought, or that spending may be more volatile. But ever since the inception of the fiscal framework, volatility and uncertainty has been a cornerstone of, you know, with great power comes great responsibility in a way. So being able to manage that as best possible through medium-term strategies, but undoubtedly it's difficult, and undoubtedly what happens in terms of Barnett Consequentials is a, a major player to the budget decisions the Scottish Government has to make.
Okay, I don't know if either of the others wanted to come in on that point, but...
In my written submission, I made two proposals which I'd like the committee to take up. The Scottish Parliament controls the legislative framework for the Scottish Fiscal Commission. There's two things which I think would massively improve the budget process. First of all, the Scottish Fiscal Commission should be asked to do what the Northern Ireland Fiscal Commission has done and actually provide systematic data on the cost of what Northern Ireland calls super parity policies. This is more generous policies in Scotland than in England, and also sub-parity policies. Now, I make it very clear in my memorandum, I'm not against super parity policies, which might be Scottish child benefit payment, it might be free prescription charges. But the point is that there's a big number attached to super parity policies and a negligible number attached to sub-parity policies. And the problem then is that public services expenditure on health and education housing gets squeezed because the Parliament essentially operates now under a fairly fixed budget. So it's very important that Parliament understands what the cost of all these super parity policies are, particularly as I say, the super parity policies are very easy to find, the sub parity policies are not to find.
You can just clarify, I thought we did know that information, like Social Security is costing about a billion more.
Not systematically across. I mean, there's no data set done by the Scottish Fiscal Commission or by the Scottish Government, as far as I know, of how much, for example, prescription charges cost and all the various different items cost. And obviously, one of the points about those kind of items, they're often very difficult to control. Once you've established eligibility criteria, the numbers drive themselves rather than become policy determined. My second proposal, and this picks up what happens in the Netherlands, is that the political parties should agree to have the Scottish Fiscal Commission cost their manifestos. Now, there's two reasons for that. Now, everybody was saying, no, you can't possibly do that. But there's two very good reasons.
Can you keep it fairly brief? Because I don't want to spend, you know, I think there would be a cost to that, and I think that's quite a political issue. But anyway, on you go.
All the manifestos that came out in the last whole election came out after about a quarter of the population had already voted by post.
Well, yes. That's another thing. Yes, so they'd have to do it.
But if what you're saying is the system is dysfunctional, you know, that's part of the problem. When you've got a fixed budget, and particularly in a context where you have a proportional representation system like the Netherlands, where likely coalition, formal or informal, is required, people will be having coalition discussions or agreement discussions without knowledge of what the policies that other parties have actually put forward. So it's a politically big jump for parties in Scotland, but I think it's essential to avoid the kind of problems that we've been encountering.
Okay, I'll leave that one just now. Thanks very much, because we could explore that further, I'm sure. Professor Bell, you make the point, but others have made it as well, that if we grow the economy, that's going to help with other priorities. But I'm just wondering if that is definitely the case, because, I mean, to take a kind of extreme example, if we started a lot of new businesses and they were all incorporated and they all paid themselves dividends, then they would pay corporation tax, they would pay tax on the dividends, but we only get the money if there's employees or self-employed people paying income tax. So the nightmare scenario would be surely that we could grow the economy substantially and get no extra money in Scotland.
I guess you'd get business rates. Okay. And then the consequence might be that you also get additional Barnett consequentials, because by providing more money to the UK government, now typically I've got to say that the Scottish economy grows broadly in line with the UK as a whole, so therefore you could reasonably assume that tax revenues are growing across the UK as a whole. There might well be some money coming back in the form of Barnett consequentials. And just to remind you that there's broadly one issue that really matters in terms of how the block grant adjustment for income tax, which is by far the most important of the block grant adjustment work, and that's income tax per head. Income tax per head really is absolutely critical in terms of how the BGA is assessed. So, in terms of growing the economy, there's that additional effect. If we are managing to grow a little bit faster than the rest of the UK, the net effect for us is positive. If the BGA, the amount taken out of our budget, is smaller.
Okay, I mean, I could possibly explore that further, but I think we're a wee bit pressed for time. Could you just ask one other question to any of you? That one of the plans for the current year is to take more of the ScotWind money out of the kind of reserve it sits in. Do you think there was alternatives to that, or is that just something we had to do? Mr. Robinson?
I wouldn't be able to comment on what the specific alternatives policy would be.
Yes.
I think that the main thing here, and again, looking to the medium term, is that a one-off source of funding is being used to meet what will be recurring costs through wages. So one of the points often raised by the Auditor General is the extent to which the Scottish Government understand the recurring nature of some of its expenditure, mm-hmm. especially those elements related to costs. So ScotWind can be used, but as Spice, I think, also set out in its blog and paper, it can only be used once.
Yes. And the alternative would presumably be to make further cuts in other expenditure.
I mean, it'd be up to the Scottish Government how it chooses to prioritise it. Yeah, but I mean, obviously, if it's spending more than it has available to spend, it's got to consider where it's going to spend less.
Yes. Okay. I don't know if either of you want to comment on that. That's fine. Okay. Thanks, Convener.
Thank you, Michael. To be followed by Michelle.
Thanks, Convener.
Excuse me. Sticking with the same issue, I mean, I suppose last week's announcements were source of quite significant dismay, I think, for many people. We're here to talk about strategic approach to the budget, but I suppose what you've just said on behalf of Audit Scotland is that this is a pretty short-term approach, taking a set amount of money, putting into to pay off recurring spending. I mean, Audit Scotland has said October 23, the Scottish Government's projections suggest they can't afford to pay for public services in their current form. In October 23 also, Scottish Government's approach to planning for future workforce and pay costs will not address current and future capacity challenges and is unlikely to balance public finances. Do you think the Scottish Government has heeded those warnings? Ask Audit Scotland.
So I think this is a very difficult one because obviously with that workforce paper we've been reporting two different things really throughout our audits, and one is say looking at the NHS overview report saying there's a system where there are vacancies and capacity concerns, and at the same time policies which say that the way to a sustainable position has to include consideration of workforce costs. So what we'd expect to see and what we recommended in that particular report is that workforce should be considered with any of its reforms and its reform measures. So we may come on to talk a bit about the reform, and I know that the Scottish Government gives 6 monthly updates around its reform progress. So the extent to which those are going to help address workforce challenges will be important. And also just understanding, I suppose, the balance of how much the Scottish Government can and wants to spend towards its workforce costs, which currently makes up over half of its costs. So one of the things that we say there is that we would expect better data, probably more granular data, in terms of the public, different public bodies in place. I think sometimes we picture the public sector workforce as one big group, whereas in fact it's employees across hundreds of different organisations. And changes to things such as the rates of pay and wages will affect different organisations differently depending on how much of their costs are made up by workforce. So it will affect the NHS differently, for example, than Social Security Scotland. So a better understanding of what that is, the difference that reform is going to make, and the comfort levels that the Scottish Government has with how much money of its budget is going to spend on workforce.
But you said in November 2022, rising costs and increasing demands mean the Scottish Government has to closely and carefully manage its position. You also said the pace and scale of reform required across the public sector needs to increase. November, a year previously. Again, doesn't seem to be any evidence that those warnings have been heeded. I mean, I've got a list of these, by the way, here about various reports from Audit Scotland over the years. Mm-hmm. It doesn't seem to be that the Scottish Government is responding to those in any way to look at the finances, even in the medium term, does it?
I think so. We will be producing a report later on in the year on financial sustainability and reform, which will cover some of these issues as well. So I think it's fair to say that we've seen another year where there have been substantial in-year changes to the budgets. So there's something about, and this has been raised, I think, by the Fraser Valander Institute as well, the extent to which that the budget that's set at the start of the year can be relied upon to not have to deal with large in-year changes. So again, some of our issues around sort of the need for data and realistic planning around what's acceptable, especially around areas of larger spending and important spending, such as capital and workforce, is really important. It's difficult in the absence of medium-term. I mean, the last medium-term financial strategy was in May 2023. A lot's happened since then, and we may not get another one until next year at some point in the spring or summer. So being able to assess the speed at which things are changing within each of the departments to make itself financially sustainable does become difficult. But as I say, we'll be speaking more about this when we report later in the year.
But you would recognise that 3 years of emergency budget reviews, very significant in-year changes, is very inefficient and certainly doesn't allow departments or public services to deliver against strategic outcomes, does it?
So I think
there's other shaking heads, I think, on the panel. But
yeah, no. So I think this probably what I would do is I would probably separate out a couple of factors, though. So one is, and this is about events and reactions. So I think it's worth remembering that over the course of the last 4 or 5 years has been particularly disruptive, in particular with COVID-19 and the 2 years of COVID-19, large in-year movements and then a little bit of uncertainty about what might come next after the COVID-19, which, as we know, included the cost of living crisis, inflation at very high levels and all the rest of it. So I think it's worth bearing that in mind insofar as within that level of uncertainty, which was unprecedented, really, in terms of the volatility facing the Scottish government budget, you would expect to see, as we did, movements during the year to react and flex the budget to meet the resources that would become available.
But the most recent revisions last week.
Yes, so I think
what are the different adjustments in the budget in year externally that required that?
Yeah, so I think that is different than meeting in year demands that arise from pay settlements, for example. So one of the benefits of, or one of the things that's been said about whether it's in year plan, whether it's multi year planning or medium-term financial strategies or the budget itself is what is a reasonable assessment of what the growth is going to be, and the scenarios that you could then plan out against that. Again, it comes back to things that we've said within those reports that you mentioned and within our submission here, really, which is understanding the flex of your budget, those elements that are fixed, those elements that can be changed but it will take time, and those elements that can be flexed quickly is really important. And mapping that against what scenarios of what both the next year and the next 3-5 years could look like, and that's missing at the moment.
Okay, Professor Bell.
I just want to make a couple of points. I guess one, Richard mentioned it has been a very unusual 3 or 4 years for a number of reasons, and actually I struggled to figure out how even a medium-term financial strategy would have dealt with, for example, the fact that UK debt repayments have tripled from 40 billion a year to 120 billion a year. It's much bigger than the defence budget. It's about the same size as the education budget in the UK as a whole now. That was partly caused by monetary policy response to the rate of inflation that followed the pandemic, which in turn has propagated very large wage demands, which the public sector were somewhat behind, and now we're in that kind of catch-up period where, although it's stretching the budget quite markedly, these demands, in a sense, were potentially predictable, given the fall behind of public sector wages compared with the private sector in recent years. I guess what one other thing around, Scottish Fiscal Commission has made the point that increasing demand on health service is going to be around 3 to 4% real growth per year going forward. And what we've seen is, as far as the NHS is concerned, if there's no increase in productivity, then we're going to need 3 to 4% more people each year going forward. And that doesn't seem sustainable at the moment. Something has to be done in relation to looking at productivity in the NHS. If you're going to attract that much more people, you've got to pay them even higher wages. That seems to be part of this catch-up. And Richard made the very real point around how the additional payments south of the border are going to be financed, whether that's done from within department budgets or through borrowing or another mechanism that will have a very significant effect on the Scottish budget. And then I guess you end up with having to deal with the consequences in the very, very short term.
And those impacts are magnified by the fact that we have a larger public sector in Scotland and also already higher wages. So a 5% of a higher number, yeah, and more of that number is more significant.
One obvious point from that is that these adjustments that have been made in year this year will follow on to next year, because people will not be, their wages will not be falling back.
Okay. Professor Heald, on your evidence so far and also your submission around super parity policies, I'm going to call those more generous policies, if that's okay for the layman's term. So, you raised these issues previously back in, I think, 8th of March 2022, so this is the time when Scotland should take stock of where it is. One thing I would like to see in the spending review is serious data on what future spend on the above parity programmes will be in the next 5 or 10 years. But you're here again now, over two years later, making this point about the gap here around the more generous programmes and our lack of understanding of it. Do you feel that there's sufficient planning around understanding that gap, being able to express what the difference is so that we can plan for the future, even the medium term?
No, there isn't sufficient data and there isn't sufficient understanding. There's also not the public understanding that if you spend more on not having university fees, student fees, spend more money on disability payments, more money on introduce benefits like Scottish Child Payment, the money has to come from the rest of the Scottish budget. And one of the if you used to look a long time ago, I used to regularly look at the Treasury's public expenditure statistical analysis that comes out every July. And at that point, Scotland spent significantly more per head on health than the rest of the UK. Over time, that's got eroded. So basically, because you've got essentially a fixed budget, I think we've got to the point now that getting more taxes in is going to be, more tax revenue in by higher rates is going to be very difficult politically and economically. So we've basically got essentially a fixed budget. We need to know how much demand-led programmes, Social Security being one, prescription charges being another. Now, what's very obvious from the political difficulties the UK government's got itself into with winter fuel allowance is that universal benefits are actually difficult to withdraw. Now, my guess is that the Treasury has been suggesting to every Chancellor for the last 10 years they should abolish universal winter fuel allowance. And previous Chancellors have actually refused to do that. In principle, I can see the arguments for abolishing university winter fuel allowance, but you needed the preparation both of the administrative procedures and of the public mood of how to do that. I mean, my understanding would... The big issue seems to be that the pension credit income limits are actually quite low. So you get a point where people fall out of benefit that probably most of us would think still need the payments. So what you need, if you're going to do things like that, you need very careful planning of what the administrative processes are going to be, what the eligibility is going to be. And it's a very... Hopefully, the UK government and the devolved governments will realise that even if you wanted to reduce some of these benefits, you have to actually approach it in a very systematic, careful way.
Okay, thank you. Just one final question, if that's okay, Convener. So we took some evidence in Dundee recently from young people about their priorities around the Scottish budget, and very good evidence it was. And their top priority was about employment opportunities and careers for the future for themselves. And I was struck by the fact that this echoed evidence we'd taken from yourselves last year, 19th September. I think it was yourself, Professor Heald, said, having an economy that makes the people whom we have educated at great expense want to stay in Scotland would be your strategic priority. I mean, can you say a little bit about whether you think that the Scottish Government is succeeding in that regard in terms of the evidence? Because it seems certainly to be one of the principal concerns of the young people that we met in Dundee as a committee.
I don't know the data, but my experience as a university professor was in Scotland was always that there was very substantial migration of our students south. So I think that is certainly an issue. I think structure of the economy is probably more an issue than tax itself, but it's certainly getting people to stay in Scotland and to come to Scotland is a really important public priority.
Professor Bell.
I haven't looked at that recently. It will be interesting. I imagine that it will be possible soon with the census on both sides of the border to interpret what's going on. Net migration flows tend to be from the rest of the UK into Scotland. So there'll always be some coming and going. I suspect that the average age of those coming to Scotland is probably higher than that of those leaving. That's an empirical question, which I only have some heuristic evidence on. I guess that's certainly the case in the Highlands, without a shadow of a doubt. But employment opportunities is something that we have not been all that good at creating. It's got to be said over the last, and that's particularly true. I think Anton Moscatelli made the point recently that all of Scotland's cities have got to kind of step up to the mark, because they're the places where probably most jobs are going to be generated.
And do you think around place-based opportunities and economic development then, for instance, in the Highlands, are there plans in place, strategies that are going to be able to deliver those kind of jobs?
Well, certainly in the remote rural areas, it's extremely difficult. And that goes back a bit to an earlier point I made, that probably you need the public sector to be there, perhaps to take slightly bigger risks and therefore induce the private sector to invest in these areas.
Thank you, Kabir.
Thank you. In the 20th century, Scotland had the lowest level of population growth of any country on earth. In fact, I think 2 million migrated in a half century before this Parliament was established, so it is a long-term issue. Michelle.
There's a lot of the areas that I'm interested in have already been covered. So I just wanted to explore the main kind of thematic about this session. I think the evidence thus far has, to me, highlighted the considerable complexity illustrated by the fiscal framework, and also kind of points to the fact there is a bit of a kind of Johari window issue going on, that, you know, politicians are driven to look at very near side issues about the budget in hand at this moment in time, when our earlier conversation about the lack of long-term infrastructure investment, CapEx and so on, I know public sector net investment was 8% of GDP in the 1960s and it dropped to 0.5% of GDP in the 1990s. This kind of big thematic framing of the UK macro economy tends to be forgotten when we're looking at this exercise. Long explanation for my simple question, that if this evidence session is about a strategic approach to the Scottish budget, what are those areas, in summing up, that you would like to pull out that haven't been considered thus far to genuinely attempt some consideration of a strategic approach to the Scottish budget? You looked at me, Professor Bell, so I'm going to go to you first.
I must admit, I was a bit uncertain when I was asked to appear today, whether I would be asked questions about these sort of strategic issues, or whether the focus of questioning would be on the problems that are currently faced. It does seem to me that you should not waste a crisis. So this is an opportunity to really put in place a more coherent strategic view. I'm very interested in looking at international comparators for this. I heard a very interesting discussion yesterday, actually, on the leading podcast about Taiwan and how public services and trust in government has been transformed basically through digital infrastructure. But I guess in terms of strategic issues, I've got to say I'm concerned about the fiscal framework and whether it has got sufficient longevity. I can't imagine that it has all that much public support, because so few of the public have a clear understanding of how on earth it works. So that's one thing. The other thing is, you know, we have talked and talked and talked about prevention, yet we haven't really grasped that nettle, and surely now is the time to do that.
Thank you. Professor Hill.
I don't think we can make much progress without better relations between the Scottish Government and the UK Government. I think that's... There's all sorts of things. The UK government making changes in year are perfectly feasible for the UK government, but they have much bigger ramifications for the Scottish government because of its limited fiscal flexibility. Equally, the Scottish government needs a better relationship with local authorities. I mean, if you read the evidence submitted to this committee for this inquiry, there are several local authority submissions, and they all make the point that there is so much ring fencing going on. There's so much ring fencing going on which deprives local authorities of flexibility. So I think one needs better relationship between the UK government and the Scottish government, and better relationships between the Scottish government and local authorities. The Scottish government is tending to treat local authorities as agents of itself in a way that certainly happens in England as well. So I think there is a better governance of these complex relationships, as well as a better understanding. Coming back to what David Bell said a minute ago, I think that the revised fiscal framework does not give the Scottish Government enough flexibility. We're going through a period of remarkable level of shocks. Now, I hope the shocks are over, but I'm not very confident that they're over. So I think that in a period of shocks, it's very difficult to balance in year on year, a budget of the size of the Scottish of the Scottish Government. The more the Scottish Government takes on demand-led expenditure like Social Security, some Social Security benefits, the problem becomes intensified. So I think there is an issue to be negotiated both between the UK and Scottish governments and local authorities. Very clearly, the council tax freeze came as a big shock to local authorities and has caused a great deal of ill will. And I think that both the UK government tends to think that if something goes wrong, we need more centralisation. The Scottish government seems to think exactly the same. We need more centralisation. My view is that generally, excessive centralisation is one of the problems of both the UK level and the Scottish level.
Final comments.
Very briefly, so I agree with everything that's been said there and the multi-government dimensions of things as well. I think what would really help would be a sense of a quantification of what's going to get the Scottish Government towards a sustainable position. So we looked at the last medium-term strategy. You know, it's quite stark. There's a gap. And understanding what's going to make the difference to get over the line, we're seeing that more clearly in the budget and the medium-term financial strategies would help. So if it's reform, how much do the Scottish Government expect that they're going to see in terms of fiscal sustainability measures from reform? And over what time frame? Because it's not all going to happen immediately. After that, when it's prioritisation, can we see clearly those elements of spending that are going to be protected at all costs because they make the biggest difference? And can we see an honest conversation about those areas where the Scottish Government is prepared to disinvest if need be during the year to manage its fiscal balance? So I think some kind of quantification or better quantification of what is going to make the difference to get towards fiscal sustainability would be quite helpful.
Thank you for everybody. I think that's a helpful thread about taking it back into the big picture and the complexity. Thank you. Thank you.
Do you think, Professor Bell, you want to add anything? No.
I was just going to say that I fully support what David's been saying in relation to local democracy. I was last week health and social care discussing integrated joint boards, and that adds a kind of layer of complexity because you're trying to marry a local democratically voted for a body with the NHS boards, and whether it's going to be successful is unclear, but gradually we've been chipping away at local authorities' freedom of action, which I don't think is a good thing.
Indeed, I'm very keen on the radical reform in that area, but we won't go into that specific area of reform, but I do want to ask a couple of final questions, one to Professor Bell and Richard Robinson, and the other one to Professor Heald. So I think the first one I'll ask is to Professor Heald, which is not specifically on reform, but it's really a follow-on to what you said, Professor Heald. I mean, after saying your answers, you've been really good in your responses today in putting forward a lot of what you have in your document onto the record, so I appreciate that. One of the things you've said, because public services, improving public services is an issue we haven't really talked about an awful lot today, but what you said is in your submission is, and I quote, "I've long been worried about the squeezing out of public services expenditure by expenditure was volatile and not amenable to precise forward planning," and that's part of what you've talked about already. You said, "In England, such expenditure as annual managed expenditure with the Treasury funding overspends due to higher claims on preset eligibility criteria, whereas in Scotland, such expenditure is effectively departmental expenditure limit, with the Scottish Government having to finance excessive expenditure of a combination of the Barnett formula term and block grant and Scottish tax revenues. This constitutes a serious risk to public services expenditure." Now, how do we actually mitigate such volatility in the current situation we are in?
I think we have to go back and think about the fiscal framework in the context of the Scottish Parliament taking on more expenditure functions that are not planable in the sense. I've already made the point. I think the fiscal flexibilities in terms of borrowing powers and having a resource backup are insufficient. I think there has to be very careful thought about that. The what you do not want, there's been a theme here about strategic thinking about expenditure, which I greatly welcome, but that will be ineffectual if you have to have panic reductions of expenditure in year. Very clear, once organisations know that if they're going to have money left in their budgets halfway through the financial year, the finance minister might come along and take it back off them. You're going to find that organisations start lower down the hierarchy, start behaving in a different way. So I think that what we do, I understand that we've gone through a period of repeated shocks, and has been made clear about some of the public sector wage settlements. Some of this is certainly catch up that ought to have been expected. But unless we get a period of stability, which I have doubts about, we're going to continue with the same problems. So I think there is an issue about early in the life of the present UK government, the Scottish government talking to the UK government about how one can manage certain of these pressures, some of which are completely outside the Scottish government's control, without disrupting the forward planning.
Okay, thanks. Now, Professor Bell, you've said in terms of the issue of public service reform, you've said there's been more growth in public sector pay at the lower end of the workplace scale than there has been at the top. Now, we know that the average employee in public sector in Scotland earns £2,400 a year, gross, and £1,500 net, on average more than south of the border. But you've said that the public sector pay policy should align with the market value of the skills needed to deliver transformational change. So do you think the Scottish Government was wrong to do it, to emphasise pay rises for lower-paid workers? Because the alternative is increasing an envelope already under strain for higher pay settlements.
Having some higher pay settlements doesn't have a huge effect on the overall budget because there aren't huge numbers of highly paid managers within the public sector. You do end up one difficulty associated with focusing on those at the bottom is pay compression, which is that differentials get squeezed, and therefore you may find that people's willingness to take on additional responsibility or additional training is weakened. That's one possibility. And then there is the other very relevant question about whether there are sufficient high-level skills within the public sector, managerial skills, leadership skills, just even technical skills, to carry through on the kinds of reforms maybe that we've been talking about, but just to make these organisations function efficiently. One strategy which I'm not sure whether it's in the long-term interest of the public sector is just to hire consultants whenever you're confronted with a problem that you can't easily solve. You hire consultants to solve it for you, and that in overall, you know, that isn't necessarily going to reduce the overall size of the effective pay bill that you face. Of course, in the health service, having an emergency agency type work is also somewhat of an issue, because again, you need to have people satisfied with the pay levels that they've got, with the working environment that they're in, who maybe would obviate the need for extensive use of external support.
Yes, and indeed, I mean, I know you were talking about HMRC earlier on, and your colleague was very good at chasing down people who were involved in tax avoidance, and the private sector doubled his salary to yeah, move from HMRC, sure. So I think that's a real issue we have. I'd like to explore what these things work further, but time's against us. So just to yourself, Richard, you've said in terms of reform, you've said it's unclear what additional spending has been allocated towards reform, what levels of cumulative savings its programme, the Scottish Government's of reform, will generate, and over what period these savings will be realised.
Yes. So I think there's a couple of issues there. One which is about a little bit related back to what we were talking about earlier on in the session, is that some of these reforms are going to take time to do and are necessary towards, whether that's preventative measures or climate or what have you. So, but it's probably similar to the point for Ms. Thompson that I was making, which is this is about how we can see the role that reform is going to have in managing towards fiscal sustainability. So some of this, depending on the type of reform, I think we put in the paper that there's different types of reform, everything from efficiencies to looking at more structural changes. Some of these may have costs to the budget, so is it clear about how those are being met? And is it clear to those scrutinising the budget, what is the expected return from them?
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you for that. We've got so much more to explore. We do have another panel of witnesses. Just before we wind up, are there any further points that our witnesses would like to make on areas that we feel we may not have touched on in the evidence? Omerta. Okay, thank you very much. I'd like to thank our witnesses for their responses to our questioning this morning. We will move to a wee break now, and we'll come back at 10:45 for the next panel. Thank you very much for...
We continue our evidence taking on managing Scotland's public finances, a strategic approach, with our second panel. I'd like to welcome to the panel Vicky Manson, Deputy Head of Policy Scotland, Federation of Small Business, David Lonsdale, Director of Scottish Retail Consortium, and David Lott, Deputy Director, Funding, Reform and Accountability at Universities Scotland. I intend to allow up to 90 minutes of this session. If witnesses would like to be brought into the discussion at any point, please indicate to the clerk and I will then call you. We have your written submissions, so we'll move straight to questions. I think the first question is it's a wee bit of a strange one, actually. I thought in terms of the answer it was just a wee bit different from what we've been asking so far. It was, it's to yourself, Ms Manson. What you said is that there have been consultations published proposing changes on a number of different areas, and you seem to have raised some concerns about the level of consultations that are embarked upon. I just wonder if you want to comment on that.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you. I joined Federation of Small Businesses back in January, and I think I've responded to 7 consultations since then across a number of different areas. I think definitely speaking to our members who are all small businesses, firstly, in terms of consultations, they are not even aware of what consultations are. A lot of the time they don't understand the content of them or the impact that they'll have on their businesses. I feel like they're kind of at arm's length from small businesses. We, as I said, have responded to quite a number of different consultations across circular economy, heat and buildings, sort of several different areas. I think the issue is that there's a bit of disconnect between small business and government in terms of when the consultations are put out. As I said, it's usually organisations like ourselves that would be responding to them, so they're really... It's difficult to engage with small businesses to understand what their opinion is of the content of the consultations. We do try and reach out and understand and hold roundtable sessions, but again, with small businesses, they lack time hugely, so it's difficult to get them engaged. So there is concerns that it's a lot of sort of paperwork and consultations and strategies without actually engaging with the small businesses and understanding.
So you think they're paying lip service, perhaps, rather than actually seriously consulting with the small business sector?
Yeah, I think there's probably more creative ways to understand how the consultations will impact small businesses. I know that my head of policy at FSB has been involved with the New Deal for Business regulatory subgroup, and there has been some progress made on that over the last few weeks, and there's been a commitment to look at... analyse the sort of deeper impact of the cumulative impact of regulations on small businesses through a more detailed BRIA. So that is progress and that's great, but I think we really need to understand how that's going to be rolled out and how the engagement with small businesses is going to take place.
Yeah, I'm going to call you Mr. Lonsdale because 4 of the 5 male witnesses today are called David, so it just makes life a wee bit less confusing, actually. We did have a Richard just as a kind of token, but you do really have to be called David to give evidence here. You know, we've also David Iser, David Phillips, loads of Davids. The regulatory burden is something, actual fact, which Ms. Manson touched on, and you've expressed concern in your own submission about that. So I just wonder if you can expand upon that a wee bit.
Sure. Thank you, convener. Thanks for the invitation to be here today. Certainly in terms of both the previous question about consultations and the point you just made about the regulatory burden, echo many of the points that Vicky has made. In addition to giving a written submission to the committee, we've also published our Scottish Budget Recommendations paper, which I've sent to members of the committee as well. And that outlines a number of regulatory initiatives that the Scottish Government is pursuing at the present time. And of course, we have to be cognisant as well of the fact that the UK government, got a new UK government, and they have quite a rich regulatory agenda as well. We saw a lot of that, obviously, in the King's speech a few weeks ago. And I think that's, you know, that's a lot to take on at a time when trading conditions for the sector are pretty tough. At the moment, we publish our retail sales and shopper footfall data. each and every month. The most recent ones covering the past 12 months show that retail sales in Scotland fell by 0.3%. So we were actually encouraged by the programme for government the other day. There were, from what we could see thus far, having digested it, no new additional regulatory initiatives coming forward. So that was good. That was, as I say, a sense that a recognition, if you like, not only of the things that we have been saying to ministers and the government, but also of the wider context in terms of trading conditions and what's happening at a UK government level. That said, there weren't any fewer initiatives coming forward, so the wide range of things that we've articulated in our budget submission and to the committee are still on the table. We've yet to get some details as to when they'll come forward. But I think your earlier question about consultations, that's important, even if we don't necessarily see eye to eye on a specific issue. It's seared in my memory the paper that was published 2 years ago by the Scottish Government on bringing in in-store restrictions on alcohol marketing. There was no consultation. They just published a paper saying this is what we're going to do. There was no real sort of discussions beforehand. So a consultation is helpful, and hopefully that will lead to a more rounded and considered viewpoint on a given issue.
I think, though, you'd prefer to participate more in the creation of some of these policies rather than just be consulted on them, would that be right?
Absolutely. So another topical example of this is we saw that in the budget last December, where the Scottish Government announced they were considering a business rate surtax on grocery stores. And that came as a total shock out of the blue to us. Completely flies in the face of the shared ambition set out in the New Deal for Business around involving business, the earliest stages of policy development, and there's a whole range of other grumps and complaints we have about that particular proposal. But yeah, as I say, business and government aren't always going to agree on every issue. We tend to be a very progressive industry. We'll engage constructively with government. We'll support most of them. A lot of the regulatory initiatives, the issue is actually to do with sequencing and just being, as I said earlier on, cognizant of the wider economic and regulatory challenges at a given time.
Okay, now just to go back to regulation for a minute, I mean, you talked about your concerns regarding that. I mean, just I wonder for the record if you can talk about which regulations you feel are surplus to requirement from your perspective and could perhaps be repealed, or others which you feel should not be implemented. And I'm going to be asking the same to Vicky, and don't worry, Mr. Lotter, I will be coming to you as well, of course.
Yeah. So
I was going to let David first because he was on that regulatory topic.
Sure. Well, as I said, in our budget submission, we've highlighted seven or eight different regulations that are on the table at the moment. The key thing really is around the sequencing of it and the regulatory burden. We don't know a tremendous amount of detail about some of them at the moment. Mm-hmm. Our understanding is it will be framework legislation that will come first and then the detail will come at a later stage. So it's quite difficult to be certain as to what the implications will be. So once we have a better understanding...
You're telling us we've got to scrutinise it.
Sorry?
You're telling us we've got to scrutinise it.
Absolutely. I don't envy you that one. But there are things, there's a whole range of things, whether that's on... there's regulations going to come forward on the selling of products high in salt, fat and sugar. As I've mentioned, alcohol restrictions in store. We've got, obviously, the MUP elevation at tail end of this month. Vapes, disposable cups, we're not convinced by that. We think there's changes already afoot within the industry that might suffice on that front. We've obviously seen new restrictions on fireworks, peat, the selling of peat. We've got the deposit return scheme, which was somewhat aborted, obviously, in the last year or so, but looks like it's going to come back at a UK level as well. We've got extended producer responsibility on packaging coming in, so there's a lot happening in this space. But as I say, the disposable cups thing, we're not entirely convinced by that, and we've yet to see a lot of the detail in some of these other measures as well.
Okay, sorry, Ms. Manson, yourself on the regulation issue?
Yep. No, I think I agree with most of what David said. It's not so much the regulations, it's more the delivery of them on the other side and how they're going to be rolled out. Timelines, I suppose, are quite a contentious issue for us. There's quite often a sort of 12-month suggested period to deliver the regulations, whereas I think, especially considering small businesses, you have to allow a little more time for them to put those new practices in place. In terms of, I think I'd probably just echo a lot of the regulations coming forward that David spoke about, the single-use cups. We don't have too much of an issue with that when we kind of see it quite similar to the plastic bags charge. It's more, again, around how it's delivered, what systems need to be put in place, financial support for small businesses, using up existing stock and those sort of issues. I think all those kind of things need to be teased out a little bit more and a time allowed for them at the other end, rather than just rushing through it to tick the box that's that through. Heat in buildings as well, around zero emission heating systems for small businesses. That's been a bit of a concern for our small businesses. Again, it's around the delivery, how they are given enough time to put those new systems in, how they're going to finance them. Currently, when we looked at research around the replacing their current gas and electric boilers, there was no finance for that. There was loans that were available. Mm-hmm. A lot of small businesses can't stretch that far to have, you know, to take on more debt. So it's looking at grants and other kind of creative ways to support them around, you know, rolling out into new regulations.
So you're suggesting, for example, that if these regulations have to be implemented, it prevents, for example, small businesses expanding or focusing on what they're actually trying to do as a business specifically?
Yeah, absolutely. We undertook a report in 2023, and some of you might be familiar with it. It was the big small business survey, and it looked at, I think, about 10 different areas of small businesses, and we had quite a lot of responses to that. One of the areas that we looked at in detail was around the admin of small businesses, and the data that we got out of that was that most small businesses spend at least 8 hours every week on admin tasks. Now, that's over and above normal daily operational duties. They are obviously quite overloaded as well, so anything additional that comes in is something that they have to create time for, and it hampers growth.
Okay, thank you for that. Now, Mr. Lott, you've been very patient. With regard to the universities, I think one of the fundamental points that you want to make is about research grants, etc. So the floor is yours on that.
Very much, Convener. Our response focuses on research, but a lot of the points I'll make are equally applied to education and training, etc. We feel research can make a contribution across all of the priorities. I think if we were to choose one, it would be economic growth. Our research base is exceptional in Scotland. It does lever in almost £1 billion of money from out with Scottish Government sources, and that creates really an asset for Scotland, which is remarkable. That in of itself, and I think it's always worth remembering, that is a significant economic actor. That's a lot of people employed, well over 10,000 people in high-quality jobs. And sustaining that is dependent on leveraging that resource. But, of course, the output of it is the key thing as well. And that contributes across the government priorities. It is the foundation from which we see innovation in our economy, which we see company creation. And I know you visited Dundee recently, you know, to kind of exemplify that. You can look at a life sciences team. Those people will be sustained by both Scottish Government resources through the Funding Council, but crucially leveraging money from other sources, both across the UK and internationally. For instance, I think the Programme for Government includes an example of work between Dundee, AstraZeneca and Scottish Government on kidney treatment that is then feeding into public services and hopefully both better patient outcomes and a better return on the public purse. Now, our concern is that over a decade, the resources made available through Scottish Government have declined in real terms, 20% against the GDP deflator, the normal kind of estimate of real terms. But of course, in recent years, that is inadequate to describe the costs that our members are facing. And actually, often those costs are rising well in excess of RPI and the normal things we're experiencing in the economy as a whole. Members are buying equipment for which the inflationary pressures are very high, for instance. And our concern is, therefore, we are seeing that asset for Scotland diminished, that certainly what could be is not now there. And we are losing share of UKRI resources, for instance, and across those research councils, Medical Research Council, Biological Research Council, Engineering and Physical Sciences Research Council, all of those are very closely aligned to the themes of the innovation strategy, for instance. So if our aim is to grow the economy, and certainly universities very much share that aim, what we need to see is a pivot back towards investment in those outcomes.
Okay, now, one of the things my colleague John Mason pointed out when we had a discussion, similar discussion this a couple of years ago, was that at that time Glasgow University had itself reserves of some £770 million. And it's difficult from our perspective to think, well, you know, I can understand exactly what you're saying, but when you look at some universities having that level of cash asset, it's difficult to say, well, we should take money out of other areas of priority expenditure, and then the Scottish Government's more or less fixed budget to fund that. So how would you respond to that? I know all universities aren't as prosperous, and perhaps Glasgow doesn't have quite as much money stashed away now as it did a couple of years ago, but how does University of Scotland address that particular issue?
So we have 19 diverse members, and they're indeed certainly in a different position. I think the reserves figure, and Audit Scotland acknowledges reserves is an important part of an institution's financial strategy, but it's important to remember it's the accumulated value of the institution. So it's going to include buildings, it's going to include equipment, and therefore you can have a rather skewed picture where you're looking at an ancient institution like Glasgow with all of those assets. But they're not assets that can be certainly very easily turned into recurrent spend on staffing and equipment and heating, etc. What one certainly should look at is the underlying operating position. And the Funding Council's projection, looking at the institution's forecasts for 23-24, the Funding Council's examination of that shows at the sector level a deficit of £75 million. Now, what the Council would like to see, and rightly, is that institutions are returning a surplus of between 3 and 5%. So that's going in the wrong direction, and one of the big reasons it's going in the wrong direction is because we have always had a degree of cross-subsidy for research, but combining that with a significant cross-subsidy for education, we are now very much reliant on income from international fees for that cross-subsidy. And those fees have very much dried up in the recent past.
So if we were to deliver the levels of innovation, productivity and economic growth which the university sector feels that we could achieve, and what sort of additional funding would you like to see from the Scottish Government in the year going forward, and what kind of private sector leverage would that be able to attract?
Sorry,
I know it's not an exact science, I'm just based on previous experience.
Looking at this budget ahead, clearly it's going to be tight. Mm-hmm. There is a figure in the existing Scottish Government capital spending review, which we will point to in our budget submission. That's about a 3% increase on the current level. Now, remembering that universities are slightly odd in this context, it's a capital budget, even though that resource going through into the research funding for the Funding Council is being spent on people and activity. So even though it's coming from the...
Sorry, you're looking for a 3% increase or 3 percentage points of increase?
Yes, that's but what that...
Former or the latter?
3% increase on the current level.
But is that all? It's not...
Well, we calibrate... Forgive me, there was more I was going to say. But we're calibrating it to where we were aware the Scottish Government's position is for this year ahead.
All right, OK.
Over time, we absolutely need to grow that research budget, and that's a conversation then about how we can increase the Funding Council's research excellence grant, research postgraduate grant from that capital source. But I think also really importantly, to try and answer your question about innovation in the economy, as the innovation strategy is implemented, it had within it a recommendation to look at innovation funding overall. There needs to be some priority given within the resources across government, including the Economy Directorate, to how we invest in innovation through universities. because at the moment there isn't that connection. That connection isn't made well enough, and we think we can amplify the impact of that money if we are working alongside government in that area.
And what does that 3% represent in cash terms, and what would it bring in terms of private sector investment over, say, 5 years?
So the top of my head, and I would need to reconfirm this with you, it's in it's in the low double-digit millions. The amplification effect that we see in terms of direct leverage, we might see a doubling of that in terms of creating that research capacity. The analysis of research activity in terms of economic value is 8-1 across the piece.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, there's quite a lot of figures here. For example, London Economics estimating that it's 12.71 economic multiplier, and resources one from UKRI. So I think all the figures you've given us, one, you know, all seem to be very positive in that direction.
May I just make one more comment? One of the things, and we have been discussing with government how we might try and achieve this greater join up on the economy side of their work. In terms of leverage, there are policy changes too. So Innovate UK has a limitation in its funding about the level of resource that can go into university projects. We think that is not suited to economies such as Scotland's, where there's an SME heavy economy, because there is a quite a challenge for a company to engage with an Innovate UK call. There's a lot of opportunity cost rolled into making that project happen. If the universities can take the lead on behalf of business partners, then we may be able to leverage more Innovate UK money into Scotland. We currently leverage about 6% of the UK total, as far as we're aware from the figures. Whilst it's dropped significantly, we're leveraging 12-13% of the Research Council money, because there it's about universities. So there are things beyond the budget that we could do in policy terms to help businesses in Scotland innovate and access resource to help them to do so.
Okay, thank you. Now, Ms. Manson, what kind of relationship does the Federation of Small Business have with Universities Scotland, and what can they do to help you, or vice versa?
Not too much of a relationship at the moment. As far as I'm aware, we're more involved with Skills Development Scotland, so probably more on a level of apprenticeships, modern foundation and mm-hmm. graduate apprenticeships, I would say. I can check that, but I'm not aware of us having any engagement at the moment with universities, but that's something I think we'd definitely be open to doing. I think kind of looking down the skills line for our small businesses, that's something that they've found us that there's been quite a large impact. Going back to the survey that we did, a third of our businesses felt that the lack of staff had an impact on their business operations. Also upskilling new employees as well is quite an issue for our small businesses as well, and meant over two-fifths of them felt that they didn't feel confident enough they had appropriate skilled staff. So that's looking at the skills side.
Okay, thank you. I'm tempted to ask about non-domestic rates, but I'm sure colleagues will be keen to come in on that, so I shall allow them to do so. I'm going to open out the session now to colleagues, with Ross to ask the first questions. We're followed by Liz.
Thanks, convener. Excuse me. David Lott, if I could just pick up on the convener's question around university reserves. You're quite right that most universities, so Glasgow's reserves come to a total of a billion, but they don't have £1 billion cash. It's not liquid. A lot of that is in the form of their properties. Edinburgh, though, has the most largest reserve of any university, about £2.7 billion. A billion of that is a cash reserve. So £1.7 billion, fair enough, that's largely their property portfolio. Surely at the point where there's a public institution that has so much in its reserve, more than the Scottish Government's historically even been allowed to have in its reserve, at that point, surely you acknowledge the challenge in the provision of even more public funding to an institution that is sitting on such a substantial cash reserve of its own. And I acknowledge that no other university is in that position, and you're here to represent the whole sector. But is that a discussion that's had within the sector, that the inequality of reserves makes a blanket approach to public funding that bit more challenging?
Firstly, probably an advantage to me to know the detail of Edinburgh's accounts, but I would observe in general that when we look at the cash figure, we need to be aware of where that's come from and what it's attributed for, and also look at the debt figure. So sometimes these figures can be very large because some of these organisations are very big, but we do need to look at the detail before reaching a conclusion that an institution's in that position. I think there's two things, points I'd make. Is one of them, the institutions are delivering activity on behalf of Scotland, teaching people, research, etc. And currently, the resource being made available for that means that they're making a loss. And that's a significant issue. What I think, if an institution is in the position of having cash, what it enables it to do is to invest and act to the benefit of Scotland. Now, if we're diverting resource, which I think is behind what you're suggesting, if we're diverting resource to make up for that deficit that I'm describing, it is removing that potential impact. So I think we need to think very carefully before starting to explore, well, actually, just at this moment, an institution may be able to make a contribution to the cost of something.
That's a fair point. I would like to expand on that in a huge amount of depth. Yes. Questions for other colleagues as well, so maybe come back to that later on if that's okay. David Lonsdale, to pick up on your point, see, your initial point of complaint around the public health levy was that the retail sector felt essentially blindsided by it in the budget. And I want to just explore that a little bit more, because the language in the budget was just a commitment to consult on the possible reintroduction of it. So can I just check, is your position that either the retail consortium or the sector more broadly should have been informed in advance that that was going to be in the budget, i.e. should have been informed before Parliament that there would be a consultation?
So yes, we were blindsided by that announcement, and obviously there was the commitment in the New Deal for Business that both government and business signed up to about being involved in policy development at the very earliest stages. That's in the document. Just to go back on how you sort of put the question, if I may, the public health levy, that's a misnomer. That's not what's in the budget. What's in the budget is essentially a new tax, or a regurgitated tax, if you like, to raise money for, and it talks about this in the budget, about sustaining the public finances. There's, other than the phrase public health levy, there's nothing about public health. It's, you know,
it's about alcohol and tobacco. It's health harming products. That's the purpose behind it. I would know I wrote that line of the budget. It's a tax on alcohol and tobacco. It's a tax on the retailers of alcohol and tobacco, which I think is pretty timely today, given that we've got the excess alcohol death figures out, showing almost 1,300 people in Scotland died in the last year of alcohol-related conditions. So in the first instance, what I'm confused about is this position that you believe you should have known before the budget. Now, I would understand that more. Obviously, we have different positions on the policy, and that's fine. I would understand your position more if the budget had announced the introduction of the policy, but it didn't. It was a commitment to explore whether it should be reintroduced. I am aware, through the answers to written questions, that you have subsequently been engaged in that process, as have others, both from the business sector, but also alcohol harm reduction charities, health experts, etc. So what I'm struggling with here is this problem that you apparently have, that the budget announced that there would be a consultation, that a policy would be explored without you being informed ahead of Parliament. If that had been a confirmation that the policy was going to be implemented, I would completely understand that. Policies shouldn't be implemented without consultation. But it wasn't that. It was just to say, we are now going to consult. You've subsequently been consulted as per the government's commitment to engage with business. So I'm struggling to understand what the issue here is.
So we are... contact is made with us on a whole range of issues before it comes to, you know, the public domain on a whole range of issues. Government touch base with us on a whole range of different regulatory issues, for example, in good time, and sometimes they take those forward and sometimes they don't. But to fill out their thinking, to make for more rounded decisions before they then decide there's probably something in this, we're going to take it forward. Then it's not unusual, it's actually reasonably common for us to be sounded out about stuff. So that's That's where we're coming from on that one, and as I say, I don't think it matches up with the New Deal for business. In terms of the public health levy and saying it's a misnomer, yes, there was something in place with that type of title sort of a dozen years ago. And yes, as you say, it was related to stores that sold alcohol, tobacco. But the long and short of the money is, the fact is, the money went into the general kitty. It wasn't ring-fenced for public health. So I do think it is a misnomer.
On that point, so let's say, take the proposals that have been put forward by Alcohol Focus Scotland. They've had the Fraser Valander Institute develop a policy proposal for them. Their proposal is that it would be ring-fenced for drug and alcohol partnerships, or at least for HSCPs. It would certainly, there was some element of ring-fencing to ensure it went into prevention, treatment, etc., specifically related to the harms caused by alcohol and tobacco. At the moment, the value to retailers, the minimum unit pricing, is about £30 million a year. I think it surprises quite a lot of people when they find out that additional amount that's paid as a result of MUP doesn't go back to the public sector, doesn't go back to the health service. It is, in fact, allowed to be maintained by the retailers. Do you not think it's right that, given that these are health-harming products, they have a significant impact, not just on people's lives, and that should be the focus today, but a really significant cost on the health service, that actually having a consequential levy, surcharge, however it's to be phrased, is only fair, particularly given that at the moment, and with MUP not being in place in the rest of the UK, retailers in Scotland actually pocket an additional £30 million a year that they wouldn't otherwise as a result of MUP. Is it not just that money, because you could set it at a rate that generates about that money goes back into the health service?
I wasn't 100% clear on where you get the £30 million from.
I think that's from Alcohol Focus Scotland.
Okay. So the Scottish Government, so if we reel the film back just slightly, I think there's a few assumptions out there about, increasing MUP would generate additional profits for retailers, and I think that's misplaced. So the Scottish Government's own BRIA, we talked about governments consulting business in advance. Normally, when they publish a proposal, they have a BRIA accompanying that, and it's the intent to involve and consult with business in advance in order to inform the development of that. So the government's, as I understand, the government's own BRIA was at pains to point out the difference between increased revenues from something like MUP and increased profits. And my recollection, my notes are telling me that the BRIA actually talked about £16 million of increased revenues from increasing MUP, and that's right across the whole drinks industry supply chain. So that's manufacturers of drinks, that's the logistics, that's all types of retailers as well. So I think there's more in it than you suggest. The other thing is, the last time when MUP was actually introduced, volumes went down 3.5-4%. As I understand it. And the other factor, I think, just to bear in mind in this sort of discussion around profits and where they're going, is in all likelihood, it's probably likely that there'll be some sort of customer reaction to all of this. So what we could see is that actually, if the price is going up at the end of this month, customers might decide to switch from own brand, whether it's supermarket own brands, to existing branded products as well, and obviously those generate, if you like, less profit for retailers themselves, because people are switching from own brand products to branded items, which they, if it's a similar type price, they'll presumably perceive them as better quality and premium products. So I think the notion that there's going to be some sort of vast profits isn't borne out by the evidence. It's not borne out by the BRIA that the government commissioned. And I'm not sure in reality that's what happened.
Thanks very much. I checked that it's Alcohol Focus Scotland figure, the £30 million. Again, I'd love to go into more depth on this one, but I'm conscious of the amount of time that I've taken up. So just finally for Vicky and the FSB, I just wonder if the FSB has any thoughts on the small business bonus scheme in terms of whether, as it's currently constructed, do you believe it's fulfilling its objectives, or there are any reforms that you would like to see to the scheme?
Yep, I think we've been quite vocal around the small business bonus scheme. Obviously, businesses in Scotland are no longer benefiting from the relief that they are in England and Wales now, and I think that's something that we've found quite difficult, and our members had found so much benefit in the relief that they had over that time. We again, kind of, as the scheme was coming, the relief was coming to an end, we spoke to some of our members, and some of them had said that they felt they wouldn't be able to continue without the support, and that it was critical in terms of continued operation and employment of locals all year round. So I think that that was a demonstration about how vital the scheme was, you know, the relief was to small businesses. I know it's unlikely that there will be any further relief on that, but it's something that we are continuing to sort of champion for. In terms of reform, obviously, I think there was around the end of 22, there was a change to some of the criteria, which meant a lot of members then had to start paying relief, the fees on that. So it would be good if there could be some sort of reform around it, and we would love to be engaged with that and have our members involved, you know, to help to shape that, definitely.
Do you have any concerns that, as it currently stands, it doesn't just benefit small businesses? So, the Parliament's Information Centre estimates that shooting estates get about somewhere between £3 and £5 million worth of relief each year through the small business bonus scheme. I don't think most people would regard shooting estates as small businesses. Do you think that there is a need to refine the scheme to ensure that it does what it says on the tin? It is a relief scheme for small businesses.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's important to distinguish the difference between small businesses and larger businesses. That obviously the challenges they face are quite different. As it stands at the moment, in terms of when people think of a small business, it tends to be a business that employs under 250 employees. But, I mean, there can be a huge difference between somebody who employs 249 to somebody who employs two. And obviously, financial challenges are much more acute to somebody who are operating with, like, you know, a husband and wife situation. So, yeah, I think from our perspective anyway, it would be important to understand that it was protecting the small business community and those members that are encapsulated in that definition.
Thank you. Thanks, Convener.
Thank you very much. List to be followed by Michael.
Thank you. Mr Lonsdale, can I come to your submission? You've spoken already to the convener about lots of different taxes that are been coming in. but you also say something really interesting here, that, and I quote, the devolution of these taxes to local authorities appears to have been done in a piecemeal fashion. And you strike up the contrast, again quoting, a kaleidoscope of differing local taxes may help to plug the gaps in council finances. However, it adds complexity and cost to the operations of businesses and makes budgeting much trickier. Can I just ask you about this? I mean, we've been looking this morning at trying to find tax structures that are a bit more efficient. Can I ask you for your views on what you would like to see happen to ensure that we don't have inconsistency and incoherence within the sort of different types of tax that we have, which are obviously, in your view, knocking consumers?
Yes, so the Scottish Government has a tax framework, and I think they're about to update that. I think it's been renamed as a tax strategy, but one and the same thing. So we think, I think there were six principles underpinning the last iteration of that, and there was a lot of good stuff in there around coherence, your point, minimising surprises, perhaps relates to an earlier point, and also having greater predictability. But I think in reality, well, that's been followed on many occasions. On some occasions it has not. So we've now got a business rate, for example, which is at a 25-year high. We've obviously, as we've talked about, got the spectre of a potential surtax, business rate surtax on grocers. We've seen question marks raised about making business rates reliefs and licenses to trade subject to fair work conditionality. And Vicky obviously mentioned retail, hospitality and leisure rate relief, which has been withdrawn in Scotland in the last couple of years compared to other parts of the UK. So we think competitiveness should be built into the next iteration of the tax strategy. As I say, we think the current six principles are good, but this should be added in as well. And a more coherent approach on all these things would play into other bits of government policy making in Scotland. So, for example, about making sure we've got town centres and high streets and retail destinations that are viable and have a degree of vitality about them as well.
Do you feel that the different types of tax, as opposed to the actual rates, is having an effect on consumer behaviour? I mean, do you think is it easy to find the evidence to suggest that consumer behaviour is being affected by the type of tax as opposed to having to pay more?
That's a good question. I think we're cognizant of the fact, this is not necessarily answering your question directly, but over and above what we've seen, obviously, in terms of income tax and changes there, we've seen some announcements, and there's been some speculation about what may happen to council tax in the coming year, and some pretty choice potential increases, if what's been reported is to be believed. Over and above that, there are a number of elements coming down the line. We've touched on them a little bit today in terms of regulation around what could impact on consumers as well. So we've talked about cuts levies, there's the deposit return scheme as well, out with our sectors, things like the visitor levy. We have the extended producer responsibility for packaging coming to effect, I think, tail end of next year. We've yet to work out the implications of what that might mean, let alone for retailers, but also for consumers at the end of the day. So there's a lot happening in this space for shoppers and pressures on household disposable incomes. And that's why we suggest in our budget recommendations paper that policymakers actually alive to these different pressures on that. And we can see that reflected in our own retail sales data, which at best has flatlined over the last 18 months or so.
Yeah, no, I follow these regularly. I mean, I think what you're suggesting is that as things stand just now, that the lack of coherence and too much inconsistency is creating a bit of a disincentive for consumers, rather than adding the competitive side that you'd like to see, where that makes businesses flourish. And I think the Federation of Small Business is saying much the same thing. Mr. Lott, could I ask you about when we were at Dundee University, which you referenced correctly in your own remarks? We heard a lot of really, really good things and some, you know, absolutely groundbreaking research, which we were privileged to watch. But we also heard quite a lot about the difficulties that universities are having in attracting the people that they need to attract, partly because of visa issues, for which my party was partly responsible, but also because of some of the situations in universities where it's much more difficult to bring your family. Is University Scotland getting quite a lot of evidence on this? And what would you suggest happens to try to mitigate that? Because we desperately need these people in our world-class universities to improve the research side. And
absolutely. So there is this distinction to be drawn. It's not absolute, but I think there's this distinction to be drawn between staff and students. And obviously at the postgraduate level, those students are often flowing through into the staff body. The visa regime makes differentiation, and the rights at PhD level and beyond are different. It's certainly a factor, as you point to, in terms of individuals' choice and the way in which they personally and their families are supported or otherwise by the system. It's a global competitive market, and the more that we can do. The recent changes affect taught postgraduate and below in terms of the dependence visas, and though that has had a very significant effect on recruitment. Mm. It's coincided with a number of other factors that have come into play in the last year or so, but it's had a very significant impact, and particularly for some markets. It is something that I don't think, frankly, we are picking up anything from the UK government that they are likely to change I think that's a shame in terms of both, obviously, for universities, but for our economy as a whole and for our reach across the world. More broadly, the rapid review of the graduate visa caused uncertainty in the market, and that causes a ripple of some significance and for some time. It also, even just the movement on the dependent side, just because this is a complex issue, applicants who are looking across the world are then uncertain, even if their concern is the graduate visa.
So, and is it easy to tell which sectors of university research and which departments are particularly suffering because of this problem, or is it a general concern?
I would have to ask my members. I haven't heard anything in discussion with them that it is just across the piece.
Mm. I mean, it's obviously been put to us before that there are issues about Scottish universities not being quite so able to be at the front end of leading research projects. That's partly a Brexit issue as well, I think, but because some of that has undercut our ability just to be at the cutting edge, and that's a great pity, obviously, because we should be at the cutting edge. I think it would be helpful if we could get some more information as to just how much this is affecting universities, because it's obviously a key to public expenditure following that as well.
Please.
Thank you.
Thank you, Michael, to be followed by John.
Thank you, Convener. I want to stick with the University of Scotland for a moment, if that's okay. Some recent announcements about the next REF cycle, which I know has filled academics' hearts with gladness across Scotland. But I was wondering about if you could describe the relationship between a 20% real terms reduction and the Research Excellence Grant, and what in the last REF outcomes we saw as slower improvement in Scotland in terms of REF outcomes in comparison to the rest of the UK.
Sector's still doing well. I think we have to always return to that. However, as I pointed to in terms of the impact on Research Council funding, that's material. In terms of the REF, Scotland, and obviously there's a time lag in the way the REFs are very long cycles. Scotland continues to perform well in two of the pillars. Where there's a real concern is in research environment. So that's really about the way in which we bring forward and develop the people in the research system and the general capacity and equipment, etc. And what we are seeing is investment in England specifically on research environment, and we are seeing a very limited investment here, very, very much more limited. And that's a real point of concern for our members when they think towards the next REF. And that is tied in with, I mean, if the Research Excellence Grant, Research Postgraduate Grant were keeping pace to some degree with costs, institutions have their own ability to invest in these processes.
Okay. And so we had an announcement subsequent to our visit to University of Dundee last week about the major grant from the UK government for the protein phosphorylation and ubiquitination unit. I'll not say that again. At the university, and that was £30 million. But I think we were very welcome, and Liz Smith has touched already on issues around international talent and also your own comments around recruitment. I was particularly concerned to ask about the management of the university about longer-term Dundonians, so not new Dundonians necessarily, and where the opportunities might arise for them to be involved in work and growth opportunities, which the whole panel is concerned about arising from this kind of work. The management were pointed at a few issues regarding the withdrawal of upskilling funding, the mainstream of graduate apprenticeship funding into the core grant, essentially the cut of that grant. Do you feel that those opportunities for the development of Scots and talent within Scotland and to get employment through these kind of major grants is still maintained, and what can we do to improve it?
So the complete removal of the upskilling money is a significant blow to institutions and their relationship with employers and individuals in terms of giving them opportunity, and that's something that we would hope in the coming budget the government will look at again, because not only do we need to restore the limited amount of money that was there, but actually grow it. If we look internationally, we're we're still doing well in terms of the proportion of our working age population that has tertiary qualification, but we're being overtaken. If we look to Australia, their ambition now is for 80%, 80% of their percent of their working age population to be qualified to tertiary level by 2050. And I don't think we're having that conversation. And if we look at our demography and giving people the opportunity in what is going to be a very changed economy, we absolutely need to have that conversation, as well as trying to bring in, as you put it, new Dundonians. So it is a very significant concern, and in so much as what we can do in this coming budget, what we're going to be looking to is the return of that upskilling money. And yes, I agree, in terms of graduate apprenticeships, they are good things, and members have seized that opportunity, and they would like to grow them and in new areas. And there's work going on around graduate apprenticeships and how we might be able to do that. But ultimately, obviously, will need to be resourced.
Okay. And in a conversation I had with a vice chancellor recently, they said to me that they believe that 14 of the 19 institutions that you're here representing today are in significant financial strife. Is that a figure you would recognise?
I wouldn't apply the end of that sentence necessarily, because I don't have that information. The information I do have, and all the projections, are that we're going to see that kind of proportion most likely in deficit.
Okay. And what are the repercussions of that?
Well, they will have to, and you're starting to see this come through in terms of reporting of the action that they're taking. They're going to have to look at their staffing numbers. They may well first go to a recruitment freeze, but they'll be looking at their staffing numbers. They will be reducing the offering that they make in terms of breadth of courses. So they're going to reduce their costs.
Okay. And I suppose touching on comments made by colleagues in terms of the significant level of reserves held by, you mentioned the proportion of a small proportion of those universities. I think the risk in terms of employment but economic benefit to the whole of the country about that, the significant breadth of the sector, some may have significant reserves and others just have next to nothing. You have a responsibility, I suppose, to, yes, represent the whole sector and tell the good story about that. But if those are significant job losses in these different areas, I mean, that the breadth of the sector in that regard is a significant public policy challenge, isn't it? But also a challenge for you to try and represent that coherently to us in terms of the risks that are at play.
Well, yes. I mean, a thriving university, as you point out, is an engine of growth, opportunity, you know, local partnership, civic development, etc., etc., and that is what is being eroded. Universities will continue to operate, they will continue to teach their students, they will continue to carry out research, but that capacity overall and the power of those institutions to make a change, both at the Scotland level and locally, is going to be less.
Okay, and finally, these sessions are about a strategic approach to the financing of Scotland and the use of public finances. I mean, do you feel that there's overall, given the short-term and medium-term consequences that you're describing, and frankly the long-term trajectory, is there a strategic approach being taken to the financing of our tertiary education in Scotland?
I think the last decade has been marked by budget decisions where at least there is the implication, is there an understanding that cross-subsidy will need to take place. And for a number of years, institutions have been able to generate that cross-subsidy. But the last 2 years have seen that cross-subsidy significantly diminish. So in that sense, if that could be described as a policy or a strategy in terms of the resourcing of the sector, that risk was always known, and the risk has crystallised. And what we now need to see is a different approach to and recognition that risk has crystallised and action in light of that fact.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. I'm just wondering how difficult it's going to be to find a joiner, a plumber, an electrician in Australia in 2050 if they go 80% of their workforce going to tertiary education. John, to be followed by Michelle.
Yes.
Yes, thank you, Convener. I mean, I was actually going to question that point. I mean, would it be the argument of the university of the universities that 80% of our population should go to university?
University solely, in Australia. It's about the qualification level across the entirety of the population at right. the tertiary level.
Yes.
So, you know, in answer to what the convener was saying, there, you know, it's about the college contribution as well.
Right.
But I guess the observation is we are going to have to focus on the training and retraining of people in our working age population.
Right.
And given changes in our economy and the greater deployment of technology, etc., that will involve a higher proportion of tertiary skills.
Mm-hmm. Because, I mean, some people would feel that already we're sending too many people to university and we're short of the kind of skills like plumbers. And I've got a nephew who just did a year at college, but he fixes wind farms and earns very good money through that.
Well, as I say, if we're doing the wrong thing, then, you know, every other country in Europe and beyond is looking to grow their graduate rate. So we would be completely at odds with that trend, and that's based...
We are ahead at the moment, though, aren't we?
Well, let's see the next census. I think we're starting, because the European Union had a very specific focus on growing the proportion of young people securing graduate qualifications. So that number is starting to rise in other countries right across Europe and beyond. And I'll be interested to see the next census as to where we actually are.
Okay, that was kind of a bonus question. I wasn't really planning to go there. Mr. Lansdale, in your submission, you say that you would like to see the cost of running the government, to reduce the cost of running the government. This would ease the pressure on funding for other services and so on. Are there risks in reducing the level of government? Because, I mean, we've seen, well, the major one recently has been Grenfell, where there was a lack of oversight, a lack of regulation, government not involved enough. Are there risks like health and safety and things if we cut the level of government?
I'm sure there are plenty of risks as well, but as I understand it, the budget scenario at the moment, there are plenty of risks in not doing something about public expenditure in Scotland and getting on top of it. We obviously saw the Finance Secretary the other day give a fiscal update to Parliament and announce a number of measures to, if you like, economise saving. Our assumption is that if there isn't further work done on that front, then we may find ourselves back in a similar situation in relatively short order, and or looking at tax rises, further tax rises as well. So that what we've suggested in our budget recommendations paper, we have actually done this for the last 2 or 3 years, a number of suggestions. We've not put figures on them, but there are areas we think that are worthy of consideration. They have been suggested in the past by things like the independent budget review. So that is, are there opportunities to outsource more, take advantage of additional capacity in the private sector? I think we put a specific suggestion in our document around Pharmacy First, which I understand is going well. I personally have used it in the last 2 or 3 months, and that's to try and ease pressure, for example, on the health service as well. The government's own spending review a couple of years ago suggested there were 129 public bodies. At the moment, is there an opportunity there to rationalise what we're doing? You know, just like any business or organisation that's represented around this table, our members are frankly having to cut their cloth on a regular basis on a number of fronts to deal with, you know, in our case, a lack of money coming in at the front door, because, as I say, retail revenues have been pretty much flatlining over the last year or two. But, you know, still got all the same cost pressures, whether that's in the supply chain, on wage roll, cost of energy, business rates, you have it. So organisations are having to grapple with these things, and we've obviously tried to point to a few areas where it might be worth looking at.
Mm-hmm. I mean, you kind of suggest, I think, as well, that, you know, if we shouldn't raise income tax because that will give people more money to spend in shops. On the other hand, there does seem to be quite a lot of money out there. I mean, the price that people were paying for Taylor Swift and Oasis, and I believe they say that 200,000 people went to Germany for the Euros, and I reckon if they spent £500 each, that's 100 million. So, I mean, some people have a lot of money out there. I'm not sure that really changing their income tax rate would impact on your sales.
Well, better declare an interest. I was in Germany for 10 days following the Scotland team, so...
I'll not ask you how much you spent.
please don't. Don't tell my wife. But certainly what we're seeing is people are, I think, off the back of COVID, people are, frankly, spending more and prioritising more experiences, whether that's following their football team or weekends away or eating out or whatever, and retail sales in that sense has taken a back seat. But if you look over the last few years, frankly, retail sales and consumer spend has been somewhat becalmed. Obviously, there was an increase in income tax in the budget. Last year, there was an increase in income tax and also council tax. I think that together that took somewhere in the region of £250 million bite out of consumer spending in Scotland. So there are a number of factors, and obviously we know that households, it looks like there's going to be quite a hefty increase in household energy bills this autumn, for what I've read is to be believed as well. So I just think we need to be alive to all of this. And at the end of the day, what we put forward is some suggestions to how to get the economy motoring. Ultimately, that is the best way to generate the tax revenues that can fund anti-poverty and other measures, public services as well. And for us, that's really about bearing down on the costs that retailers themselves have to spend on so they can invest in growing their business and all the rest of it, but also helping consumers spend as well.
Yeah, I mean, would you accept that there does need to be some redistribution of wealth or income within the population? Because, as we've just been saying, some people have a lot of money, can do a lot of luxury things. Other people are in poverty. I mean, it's not automatic, is it, that if we grow the economy, people in poverty are helped?
No, but that's probably one of the top ways to do it, is to provide more money to help grow the economy, create more economic opportunity for people who don't have jobs, for example, and that's not the only indicator of poverty, to get those opportunities and to get on.
Okay. Ms. Manson, thanks for your submission as well. One of your themes seems to be reducing rates, business rates, non-domestic rates. Have you suggestions as to how we should fund that?
I suppose in our response to the programme for government, we did speak a little bit around, and we used exactly the same phrase about small businesses having to cut their cloth accordingly, make lots of different changes in terms of financial pressures that they had put on their small businesses. And I think I caught the tail end of the last session, but you'd already delved a little bit into the data from the Scottish Fiscal Commission in terms of the public sector pay that was higher in Scotland than it is in the UK. So I think there are ways to save money in terms of public sector pay. Obviously, the more that rises, the less money there is for other areas to spend, and the more the tougher decisions that have to be made. Non-domestic rates is a big issue for a lot of small businesses. They are huge sums of money for small businesses, and I mean they're astronomical when you compare them, I suppose, to domestic rates. Taking away, having that small business bonus scheme in place did relieve a lot of pressure for a lot of businesses. And that just meant that they were able to grow and, provide more towards the economy and socially as well. So I think the benefits of cutting rates will increase so much more in terms of economic activity.
Mm-hmm. I mean, there's a lot of talk around means testing these days on personal issues, winter fuel payment and such like. I mean, should we also be trying to do that with businesses? Because it strikes me you could have a small business which is incredibly profitable and a small business which is struggling. Same in the hospitality sector. I see some which appear to be doing very well and others which are very quiet. should we be targeting our support? If we've got limited money, should we be targeting at the businesses that are struggling?
I mean, of course, I can't comment on specific businesses. There are some that do exceptionally well, and there are some that are just, you know, making ends meet, and there are some that are really struggling. It would be good to do an analysis of those businesses and to look at what the drivers are that, you know, that what sets apart the ones that are doing really well compared to the ones that are really struggling. I suppose in terms of means testing, that is an approach that could be looked at, to target those businesses that are really struggling. I think probably what you will find is the ones that are doing really well and thriving are probably have been established for a lot longer and have been able to kind of ride the wave over COVID, compared to others that maybe just set up prior to COVID or are fairly new.
Because, I mean, we do get some, you know, in Glasgow, some very good examples of businesses in the hospitality sector which are expanding and mm-hmm. seem to be doing very well. So,
yeah, and I think there's probably practical lessons as well that can be learned from those businesses, in terms of their practices and what they've done to succeed as well. So yeah. It's not all about the financial side of things, but certainly I think any financial assistance that can be given to the smaller businesses that are struggling would be really appreciated.
Okay, thanks, Convener.
Surely, though, if you means test them, then that would mean, for example, that businesses that are doing particularly well, that are innovative, that are profitable, that have got products that are in demand, are disadvantaged of those that might not be as well run, that might be selling something that nobody particularly wants, an allocation that nobody particularly visits. I mean, that's the opposite side, surely, of what Joan said.
Yeah, I mean, we've got members across lots of different sectors. We've got a lot of sort of innovative, you know, products and businesses that are coming through the doors. We've also got a lot of bread and butter, I suppose, members as well. You know, like joiners or retail, you know, small news agents, those kind of things. Whereas we've got other people that are coming up with amazing kind of carbon capture technology and different things as well. I think the approach to different types of businesses has to be thought out quite well, because it's not going to be the same for a newsagent as it is for somebody who's, you know, carbon capturing energy. So,
okay, Michelle, to be followed by Jamie.
Good morning. Just a few random questions from myself. I wanted to ask you, David Lonsdale, about your intriguing comment about competitiveness pertaining to tax strategy or framework, as you described it. I wonder, can you give us a bit more flavour about that? And I'll just quote for the record, tax strategy should include an additional principle of competitiveness to stimulate greater levels of private sector investment and consumer demand to ensure a strong economic recovery. Thank you.
I'm glad somebody found the document to be intriguing. We'll take that as a compliment. May not get too many compliments if that is indeed the case. Certainly in terms of what you're asking about, I mean, you know, the Scottish Government have made a number of changes, for example, to non-domestic rates over recent years, and we've been fully supportive of them in terms of more regular revaluations, the commitment to restoring the business rate parity for larger premises with Down South, and there's one or two other examples as well. Where we think they've fallen short is, Vicky was talking about, I think, earlier on, about retail, hospitality and leisure rates relief, which is less generous here than it is Down South. As I say, in terms of the higher property rate, there's about 2,500 shops that fall within the crosshairs of that, about 12,000 commercial premises overall in Scotland across a whole range of different sectors that fall within the crosshairs of that. And for our members alone, that's costing them an additional £10 million a year. We've also mentioned the potential surtax on grocery stores as well. So there's a number of areas where we could be more competitive, and we think that would be positive in terms of the message it sends out to business, in terms of Scotland as a place to invest, but also in terms of, frankly, trying to cope with trading conditions as they are and with the volume of regulatory initiatives
coming down the track, which all require, all expensive and all require retailers to frankly shell out to do a lot of these things, then I think it's the right approach as well. And also, it's actually outlined in the New Deal for Business agreement between the government and the business community. And so I think getting that reflected in the next iteration of the tax strategy, we'd touch on the points we talked about earlier on around coherent policy making.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, thank you. That's very interesting. I suspect it will be picked up further. I wanted to come to you, Vicky, and quite an intriguing quote in your submission. And again, I'll quote just for the record, it is simply impossible to expect to see an increase in economic activity when the proposed economic national outcome intends to deprioritise economic growth. And I think you're referencing to a wellbeing economy there. Now, obviously, this area has been looked at. We know there's work underway. But I'd like to hear a little more flavour as to what you mean by that. And given that this was submitted prior to the budget, do you have now more confidence around the presentation within the budget in terms of encouraging economic growth?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that was a really strange one that I had to reread it about three times and check with my colleagues that was what it meant. But it said, I think the wording was wellbeing economy, sustainable and deprioritising economic growth, which I thought was really odd wording. But obviously since then, you know, things have moved on, and in terms of a programme for government, you know, there was some really encouraging things that we heard in that. I think one of the things that stuck out for us, we've spoke about procurement a lot at Federation of Small Businesses, and there was the commitment to bring forward the Community Wealth Building Bill. We think that there's a really good opportunity there to level playing fields for small businesses in terms of public contracts, because that's been an ongoing issue for our members, just not getting a bite at that at all, really, over the years. There has been movement on the procurement reform, but we still think there's quite a lot of work to do, and we think that bringing this bill forward will provide an opportunity to possibly put in statutory targets for small businesses to access public contracts. I know that my colleague had given some evidence, I think, a couple of months ago on procurement, and they also gave me some data around micro-operators' spend on goods and services has fallen from 7% to 4.7%. And that's between the period of 2016, 17 and 21, 22. So it actually shows that we're going backwards a little bit. So we're hoping that with the Community Wealth Building Bill, that there will be something built into that to support small businesses to get a fair bite out of the apple in terms of public contracts.
And I suspect some of those themes will be picked up at the Economy Committee, of which I'm also a member, so yeah. That's convenient. My last wee question actually is picking up on something that my colleague Ross kind of alluded to. And I'm interested just because this is a sort of strategic look at the budget, the panel's view is a throwaway question around apothecated taxes, i.e. kind of aligned for particular purposes, because what we've seen is, in effect, using the term ring fencing, that kind of principle being passed on to councils and yet not applied to government itself. And I think Ross gave an example in terms of minimum unit pricing, and also obviously there's a ScotWind monies, the £640 million, that there had been a suggestion that they would just go on building supply side infrastructure and so on for renewables. So it's a bit of a kind of throwaway question. What's your thoughts about the principle of apothecated taxes, and is that something that would intrigue you, given that this session is about strategic kind of budgets? David Lonsdale, you've gone first. Sorry, David.
Thank you for that one. I think we're open to suggestions. Mm-hmm. It's difficult when you don't know that if there aren't specific suggestions to sort of understand the pros and cons, mm-hmm. and whether these things would work in good or bad economic times. Just to pick one example, we have the UK government a number of years ago brought in the apprenticeship levy. Mm-hmm. And in theory, that's hypothecated to spending on apprenticeships. It's in the name.
But it's not the case unless you, if you're in Scotland, Wales, or Northern Ireland. So, as I understand it, the revenues are collected UK-wide. They go into the Treasury in England. Firms or employers who are liable for the levy can actually claim most of it back for spending on apprenticeships. But the way it works in Scotland, Wales and Northern Ireland, it's effectively money goes into the Treasury, it comes back through the Barnett formula. The Scottish Government, like the other devolved governments, you know, spent this amount beforehand, it was taken away from it in a sense, and then the apprenticeship levy came in. So we've got this tax where retail employers in Scotland and other employers who are subject to it, they don't get the money back to then spend on apprenticeships. It's effectively an employment tax. So I'm deliberately citing an example that isn't particularly great and doesn't inspire much confidence. The previous iteration of the public health supplement, as I said, you know, that was in play a dozen years ago. The money just went into the general kitty. So, slightly sceptical, to be honest, about the notion. But as I say, if sensible proposals come forward, we'll obviously look at them in the round. Ideally, they wouldn't be affecting retailers or customers.
I think that an excellent response. By me asking that question, I wasn't making a singular play for hypothecated taxes. It was merely a question. Anything to add from David or Vicky on that? Because I appreciate that's a bit of a left field question.
No, I think just kind of reiterating what David said about ring fencing, I suppose one of the most recent examples of that for us is with the visitor levy. Mm-hmm. I know that's still going through sort of analysis, but again, the expectation, I think, from small businesses was the money would come back in, you know, to the community and be used for services. So, and again, with single-use cups, and I know we're still going through the consultation for that as well, but that charge that's applied, I know the intention is to give some of it back to small businesses for operational costs. But again, there's a question around, is that ring-fenced or is it going to be lost in the abyss?
Yeah, so actually I think you've touched on the subtle point I was making, which is less rigid than hypothecated taxes, but following the funding of these kind of things. Okay. Thank you, Convener.
I was just going to echo the point about the apprenticeship levy. I mean, you know, in principle, I suppose you look at it as many hypothecated taxes and you think, well, okay, the employer will want to train and looks at that. I think, you know, our members experience employers wanting to engage in graduate apprenticeships, and the way to resource that is not clear. As was mentioned earlier on, they've been rolled into the overall funding system, but without any extra money. So the ability, it's the implementation, isn't it? And you know, if there was that resource readily available through that route, then perhaps one would perceive that as a hypothecated tax, as one that is working well. But at the moment, I don't think there's that clarity for employers and the organisations that are going to provide the training.
Yeah, okay, thank you.
Tempted to see something I'm not going to. Jamie?
Thank you very much, Convener. Good afternoon to the panel. It was just a couple of questions I had, and the first one was to David Lonsdale and to Vicky Manson. And it's really following up some of the questions that have already been asked. I mean, both your organisations obviously welcome a kind of refocus on economic growth, or a focus on economic growth in the recent statement. But we've seen over the last number of budgets the funding for enterprise bodies cut. We've seen visitor levy has just been discussed. DRS obviously introduced, huge costs to the sectors, dropped. Short-term lets licensing, the regulatory burdens go up, and obviously the differential between UK, the rest of UK and Scotland in terms of rates relief. So I suppose looking for an honest answer, while you may welcome a refocus on economic growth, how confident are you that it will be delivered?
Ladies first.
Thank you. I think that's a really difficult question. Mm-hmm. You know, there were some things last week in the Programme for Government that we were encouraged by. I think the main thing for us is seeing actual concrete actions. And I know the First Minister, when he came in May, you know, he spoke about reducing you know, strategies and consultations and actually having concrete work done, you know, that was going to make a difference. So I think that's probably the key to it, is to be able to have those commitments brought forward to see, you know, for us to be able to see how that's going to impact, well, for us, for small businesses. I think the way things are just now, it's going to be challenging again for this next year. There's no doubt about it. But again, it's you know, does that burden fall on small businesses again? Are they going to have to further make reductions and try and cut the cloth, as we said, you know, again, to try and just see it through for another year? So, yeah, that would be my answer.
Okay, and David Lonsdale?
I think I'm essentially echo what Vicky was saying. So, you know, the First Minister in his party conference speech talked about investment in his programme for government last week. He said all the right things about creating the conditions for commercial investment and investment-friendly policies. I think, you know, as I said earlier on, we didn't see any new regulatory initiatives that would sort of concern us coming forward from the programme for government. But as Vicky says, there's a whole range of things that are on the table at the moment in terms of cumulative impact that we need to grapple with. So it's you know, we're encouraged by the direction, but it's that sort of horny old chestnut about you know, the proof of the pudding will be in the eating at the end of the day. And obviously the budget is, the Scottish budget is a key test in that respect. As I said, I've already walked through several of the areas where we have some concerns, and we think there needs to be further action to be able to deliver on the objectives, because it's a shared objective about growing the economy, you know, bringing in better revenues for the public services and alleviating poverty and all the rest of it. But we need to get the economy moving, and that actually requires some action from our perspective on the regulatory front and on some of the taxes that we've outlined in our budget submission.
Okay. David Lott, if I can come to you, and it was just really, you've talked about the kind of cross-subsidy, particularly on some of the funding for, sorry, some of the focus on research. Just a very kind of simple question, is there a concern that if there is a tightening or a squeeze on some of that funding research, that the focus from universities may well be on return on investment and some of the kind of areas where the largest grants are, and therefore we might see some of the more some of that research on areas that might have particular social good deprioritized?
I think it's worth stating that our research effort as a whole requires cross subsidy. So there will be some elements which are closer to breaking even or may generate a surplus, but overall, what I fear is that we will just do less. Now, I couldn't break down where that loss will reside, but we will do less. And by having fewer and smaller research teams, we are not generating that very direct economic impact. I've had regular discussions with Scottish Government that leverage of research money should be seen as a foreign direct investment. It's very significant as an economic entity of itself, but then of course it flows into all those other benefits we discussed earlier. I think institutions would have to take a view. Over the years, they have noted that some institutions have noted that as the resource through the Scottish Government reduces, they are becoming much more selective about what they bid for because they frankly cannot afford to win. And that seems a very poor place for Scotland to be in.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Okay, just one further question for myself. Vicky, you've said that to make the economy grow, it's crucial that support is given to small businesses. They make up almost all enterprises, and you've talked about the reintroduction of targeted release for the retail, hospitality and leisure sector. Now, obviously, £685 million is going in rate release across the board this year, but I'm just wondering, given that the Scottish Government is under severe pressure with its budget, which is more or less fixed, unless we put taxes up, obviously, which no one seems to be keen on at this point in time, apart from John, obviously. But I'm just wondering, given what we heard from David Lott, who said that £10-15 million, for example, in additional funding for research could perhaps bring in 8 times that amount in terms of economic activity. Should money, scarce money, not go, for example, to that sector to create greater innovation and productivity and output than, for example, small businesses, if there's additional money to available? I mean, that's the kind of thing, obviously, that government is wrestling with. So what would you say in response to that?
Yeah, I mean, there's obviously going to be an argument from everybody for, you know, who gets a share of the pot. I would say that small businesses are, they do make up 99% of all businesses in Scotland. That's a huge amount. They contribute £110 billion to the economy and employ over 1.2 million people. So that, I think, itself demonstrates their contribution towards the economy. And without that, you know, where would we be?
I completely agree with that. I mean, I think that's a really important point. But £10 million and something of that scale would have surely an infinitesimal impact, whereas £10 million or £50 million could have a significant impact in terms of Scotland's R&D footprint and its international global competitiveness at university level.
Yeah, I think, yeah, of course, it would have an impact in terms of universities, but I think you know, there is a bit of a probably disconnect between small businesses and government because, well, for a number of different reasons, I think they maybe feel a little bit overlooked sometimes, just because that relationship probably isn't there, and then it falls on organisations like us to try and bridge that gap. I think in terms of what small businesses provide to the economy, you know, in terms of employment, supply chain, you know, they want to be involved in all the net zero, you know, initiatives and all these kind of things. I spoke about public contracts earlier. They've got a real value to Scotland, and I think by providing some financial support to them, it could have real benefits, even for, you know, you're saying it's a small sum of money, but for small businesses, actually, that's probably got a much bigger impact than it would on larger organisations. And I think not only would it help to boost them in terms of financially and in growth, but it would maybe reinstate a little bit of confidence for them, you know, through the government and help them to engage more proactively as well.
Okay, so David Lawrence, where do we strike this balance? Because I know that it was when the UK government had consequentials last year for hospitality sector, apart from in the islands, which I lobbied for, that wasn't passed on. The Scottish government said, yeah, we're putting the money into the NHS. Now, people who run small business and want retail also rely on the NHS, just like everybody else. So where do we strike that balance, given the kind of restricted nature of the Scottish budget in terms of what we provide for example, the retail sector and the businesses you represent in the wider Scottish budget and economy?
Well, I think I would just remind you that, you know, the business rate's at a 25-year high. I've said already that there are several thousand shops in Scotland and other businesses that are paying a higher business rate than down south. We've got, as I said earlier on, we've got this threat on the table at the moment about a potential surtax on grocery stores. So, you know, I think we need to just take some of these things in the round at the same time. Obviously, we were not exactly happy about the fact that Scotland got the consequentials but didn't then replicate what was happening in Wales or England at the time. But, you know, we don't envy, obviously, the finance secretary and what she's got to do, but I think there are broader areas out there that require action as well. We just need to be alive to them.
Okay, thank you very much for that. Now, obviously, time's against us. I just want to give our guests an opportunity to say any final points if they so wish. Vicky, you would be last because you started off first. So I don't know if David or is there anything further you would wish to add? David Lonsdale? Yep.
May, your first question, I think, to me, convener, was around are there regulatory initiatives that we don't think should be taken forward? And one of the ones we put in our submission to the committee, but also in our wider Scottish budget paper, is around consideration being given to applying fair work conditionality to business rates reliefs, but also licences to trade. And that's something that was in the Scottish Government's Fair Work Nation document last year. I'm not totally convinced that the potential implications of that were actually factored in at the time, but that's something
just to answer your particular question.
And are you hoping that the new UK government will look at, for example, the imbalance between businesses and the high street paying rates and online businesses, for example? Is that something you're looking at?
I think the new UK government have talked about reforming business rates down south, and any change that comes in could have Barnett consequentials or may influence the policy here in Scotland. I think we're shy of the detail of that and what they mean in practice. We'll see whether or not in the budget, for example, the new Chancellor will say a little bit more about that. I think we're shy of details, and I guess that's where we are on a lot of different issues at the moment, both in a Scottish and a UK context.
Indeed. So, Vicky, the last word's with you.
Yeah, I think just going back to your final question around, you know, how the pot's shared, I suppose. For us, you know, we believe the Scottish Government's got legislative levers that they can use, and I know we've spoke at length, myself and David, around the cumulative impact of regulation. And just looking, you know, that in itself, reducing that for small businesses would be a huge, you know, positive impact for them. So it's seeing those promises translated from words into actions. And that's actually something that can be done, you know, in terms of financially, probably, you know, fairly easily.
Yeah, minimal costs to the government, but a benefit to business.
Yeah. And then again, you know, with the community wealth building bill as well, I spoke about public contracts and just putting that statutory target in there for small businesses to get an opportunity to bid for public contracts. Again, that's something that could be, again, quite easily introduced, but have a huge positive impact on the small business community.
OK, thank you very much. I'd like to thank our witnesses, Dalo, and Vicky, for their evidence this morning. We will, of course, be publishing our thoughts once we've taken further evidence. I'm just going to call a 2-minute break in order for the official report broadcasting to leave. And then we'll go into private session.